A very good morning and welcome to the 28th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2024. We have no apologies this morning, and the focus of our meeting today is on policing and mental health. Now, this is an issue that we've been looking at as one of the committee's priorities this session, and we've been concerned about the impact that the work carried out by police officers and staff can have on their mental health and well-being, and the growing demands on policing from people in distress in communities. And we want to be reassured that there is adequate support for officers and staff in the important roles that they carry out for us. Recent events have more than demonstrated what the public ask of police officers and staff, and the committee is keen to ensure that they are provided with the support they need. So I refer members to papers 1 and 2. We have 3 panels this morning, and I intend to allow around 60 minutes for each panel. And I would be grateful if questions and answers can be as succinct as possible. So our first panel today consists of representatives of the police staff associations and trade unions. So I'm pleased to welcome Superintendent Suzanne Smith, Vice President of the Association of Scottish Police Superintendents, Mr David Threadgold, Chair of the Scottish Police Federation, and we are hoping that David Malcolm, Branch Secretary from Unison, will be joining us shortly. He's just been slightly delayed. And so thank you all for providing written evidence. So I wonder if I can start this session this morning with a general question just to set the scene. And I'll maybe come to David Threadgold first, and then I'll move on to Superintendent Smith. So since the committee last looked into this issue back in November 2023, or last looked at this issue, do you think the wellbeing support provided to officers and staff has improved? And what more do you think needs to be done? David.
Thank you, Convener. You're right to say that it's an issue that, you know, challenges every day in the work that we do, and we see the consequences of and the impacts of being police officers in the work that we do every single day. I think it's right and appropriate that I frame any of my remarks today around, and it's mentioned in my written response about, you know, the genuine belief that I have that the commitment of the Chief Constable is to address these issues and to make our workforce and the experiences that we have as police officers, you know, as preventative as they can be to stop us from going through some of the things that we see in our everyday work. The question specifically about, you know, whether this has got better, I think there are some challenges still. I have noted the response from Police Scotland in their submission, and, you know, the mitigations that are identified in that document, I have some challenges with some of them, which I'm quite happy to go into because I think that's relevant, if, you know, with your permission. Because what I don't want to have is a situation where this committee thinks that, you know, everything that is written in there is the final, you know, the finished article to prevent my colleagues from becoming ill. And I think, to summarise in one sense, we have to get much more into the preventative space rather than the absolutely reactive space, which a good number of these things are. I'm happy to go into some more detail if you wish.
Yeah, I'll maybe bring in Suzanne Smith, and then we can maybe come back to you before we open up questions to members. So I'll bring you in, Suzanne.
Thanks very much, Convener. So from my perspective, I absolutely believe the Chief Constable's commitment and respect of doing all she can to support officers and staff who are involved in the activity to service people across Scotland. What I would be keen to do is probably just to accelerate some of those initiatives so we begin to feel the benefits of those. We are very good at the point of crisis, you know, in those reactive spaces when things have gone, you know, horribly wrong, but we just need to get better in that space of the intervention prevention, you know, as we do, you know, across criminal justice, but particularly around that support for our staff. And in respect of senior management, for me, it's that training around HR issues and understanding, you know, my role. We do get a lot of support from people in development, but it's often tactical advice and you're left to, you know, make quite bold decisions, which undoubtedly will be part of, you know, scrutiny should things not go right and we're maybe not always trained, you know, to the right standard. You know, I've been a senior leader for since about 2018 and I haven't had any senior management, you know, HR training. So you feel like you're sometimes finding your way. And yes, you get a lot of tactical advice from people in development, but I think we would all benefit you know, from that expertise, which they're currently building a programme around that, but I would just probably like to see some of that accelerated so we can reap the benefits.
Thank you. That's a really important point that we will come back to in terms of sort of leadership and training. Thankfully, David Malcolm, you've joined us, which is great. It's good to see you. So I'll let you get settled. And I'll come back to you yourself, David, just in terms of your opening remarks. I was particularly interested in the fact that you want to see a bit more sort of preventative approaches and that as more of a focus, perhaps.
I think the way that we're structured, the demands on police officers, the spans of command that we have and the interaction that, particularly when you look at constables, you know, by definition, the most numerous of officers in Police Scotland. The feedback that we've had, and I will always try and be evidence-based in the remarks that I have, you know, we have done some work prior to this session with around 1,600 responses from officers to you know, allow me to be hopefully very accurate in what I say today. And the lack of interaction or the lack of appropriate interaction between constables and their sergeants is a key issue in how they deal with the stresses and demands of being in the police. What I mean by that in simple terms is that if you do not have that relationship with your supervisor so that they can identify if you're not yourself today, and I'm sure everyone knows what I'm talking about, but it plays into some of the responses from Police Scotland if you're talking about TRIM, for example. TRIM is a key programme that we have for officers to deal with, you know, trauma in policing. And some of the feedback that we've had is that it is an absolutely excellent programme and it delivers exactly what we would like it to do. And I know that it's referenced in the strategy that Police Scotland has developed, but there is very clear evidence that it is far too easy to avoid becoming part of that process because you can just say no on the phone. And that is because of a number of reasons, that lack of contact and knowledge with that person making the call. Just a desire and understanding that you do not need to get involved in this process and it is far too easy to say no. And the consequence of that is that my colleagues who perhaps are struggling but don't want to identify that they are to their colleagues will get missed. And I know that in the lifelines, you know, we'll come on to lifelines, I've no doubt, there was a very simple analogy in that programme, and I've done three, you know, programmes that are referenced about a waterfall. You have calm water, then you have the waterfall, then you have chaos at the bottom. We have to get much, much better at dealing with colleagues in that preventative space in the calm water rather than pulling them out at the bottom, because as Susanna said, we're quite good at that. But I'm not convinced yet that we have the mechanisms and the structures in place to allow us to be preventative and identify colleagues who are struggling at the start of that journey rather than picking them out at the end. And that is the key driver, and the main reason for that is that lack of supervision and that lack of contact with line managers.
Okay, that's very helpful. And the analogy is good and I think helps us see what you're what you're referencing. Okay, thank you for that. I'm going to bring in David now. And earlier on, David, I asked just a very general opening question just in relation to the fact that obviously the committee last took evidence on this issue around mental wellbeing and policing back in November last year. So I'm interested in how you think things have improved and what still needs to be done from your perspective.
Well, I don't think it will surprise anyone to know that I don't really get good news stories being a trade union rep. No one actually really comes to me and says, I've had a really good experience, this has worked really well for me. So the improvements, I can see what we're working towards, I can see what Police Scotland and the SPA are working towards, I can see that in the reports that have been submitted today. But the actual evidence of that amongst my people doesn't really come forward. I tend to hear still the stories that people are unable to access good support from line managers, team leaders and the various services that Police Scotland have set up for them.
Okay, thank you. Right. I'm sure we'll come back to that. And at this point, I'll bring in other members and I'll start off with Rona Mackay and then Sharon Dowie. Rona.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I wanted to ask you about increasing levels of staff and officer absence and an increase relating to psychological disorders. I just wondered if you could expand a bit on what you think the reasons for these increases are, and it may be related to what you've just said previously. And do you think they've been adequately addressed by Police Scotland and the SPA? And what is the impact on the workforce of these absences?
For
David,
myself?
Yes, yeah. David.
Thank you. It's a really interesting question, and I don't think I can answer it by sticking absolutely to the subject that we're here to discuss today. And what I mean by that is, if you look at increased absence, our officer safety training, for example, you know, at the moment we have 3,500 police officers in Scotland who are not officer safety trained. That means that, for what that means is, you know, batting and handcuffs, you know, the tactical skills that require us to de-escalate situations. That has been identified, you know, to the authority and was discussed at the People Board meeting the other day. The consequence of that is that my colleagues are going out there without the most up-to-date training that they can possibly receive, and there is clear evidence that when that is a situation, officer assaults, you know, assaults on police officers increases, and there's a clear link between that and those who are absent with physical or psychological issues. So that is one aspect of it. When you look at the document, the strategy document, you know, it's aspirational, it makes absolute sense, but we have to, what it's lacking in my opinion, and it's probably because it's, you know, it will come, but how do you balance and make that a priority to deal with the wellbeing challenges that exist in the organisation when officer safety is a priority, when driver training is a priority, when first line manager training, in fairness to the service, the discussions I've had with the executive, you know, I believe there will be a genuine focus on this now, but it means that it has to become a priority. When you look at the number of probationers that have come into the organisation and the training commitment required for them, those people required to train them have got to come from other areas of business, which puts pressure on them. And there is an ever decreasing snowball. And bear in mind, all this has come really off the back of having a balanced budget last year, which is absolutely accurate. But that £19 million projected overspend, even if it had been that, we are going to see the cost of that multiplied many times over in the ability to deliver policing across Scotland, not just because of the health of my colleagues, but in the services that we can provide. So I don't know if that's much of an answer for you, but...
No, that's really helpful. Thank you, just to get the context of it. Suzanne, would you like to comment? And David, you don't have to, but...
Yeah, so just really, I manage absences for my division, which is Tayside, over 900 people, staff and officers. We have seen an increase in absences when stress is a contributing factor. Some of that is work-related due to some of the trauma experienced by staff and their roles. Some of that is due to external factors, you know, fiscal challenges, you know, other societal impacts as a result of COVID, etc. And I suppose you're asking, you know, what's the impact of that? The impact is I've got less access to resources, which means I've got less officers to respond, which means I think the committee's already heard that drip-drip effect. You know, normally there's increased numbers out there to dilute that trauma, but that's reducing and reducing, which means that drip-drip happens slightly quicker. That's the impact of that for me. Over time, rest day disruption, so they're not getting the same rest periods.
As a knock-on effect.
Yes. Yeah.
Thank you. David, do you want to comment on that?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you have to look at what the reasons for absences are among staff, and you've got staff working in areas of the business where they're actually designed to work with overtime as built in as part of the structure because there aren't enough staff to do the jobs, there isn't enough budget to pay for the staff, and you know, so it's designed on overtime. People are going to do that, they're going to burn out, you know, that's going to affect them. They're struggling to get leave, they're struggling to get breaks on shifts. People are going to get run down, they are going to be unwell.
Okay, thank you. And just one final question. David, you talked about the TRIM initiative, the TRIM programme, and some people didn't feel they wanted to take it up and it would benefit them. Do you think it should be mandatory at all, or should it always be the choice of the person?
I think at the moment I know at the moment that it's a voluntary programme. I think to mandate something like that could be detrimental, but I think that if we had, you know, better, more efficient, more engaged processes, you'd probably see a great uptake in those who benefit from being part of that programme, because the key point at the moment, and, you know, I use my own brother who's in the police as evidence of this, is it's just far too easy, if you receive a phone call at all, to say, I'm okay. And that doesn't deal with the potential trauma that, in his case, a traffic officer will go through. Clearly, there are examples from within, you know, police officers and staff. Could I just pick up on one point that David made, that if that's okay, and it was to do with overtime, and this is a really important point, because the Chief Constable will say that we are people-focused, and I absolutely, you know, I believe her when she says that, but the challenge is that when our budgeted establishment is so far below what it needs to be, the impact that that has on a reducing workforce, how do you balance that when we go to the police authority and say that we are effectively providing a policing service by using the money that we are not spending on that full-time resource, you know, to get us to that full-time equivalent? So there is a clear imbalance in the reality and the words here in terms of welfare, and it has the, you know, the effects that have been spoken about so far. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. That's helpful. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Sharon Dowie and then Ben McPherson.
Thank you. Kind of following on in the same thread that Rona Mackay was on, the submission that came in from the SPS says that there is a growing number of police officers unable to carry out full operational duties and placed on modified duties. This can be for a range of medical reasons, including mental health, and there currently does not appear to be a coherent strategy to reduce this ever-increasing number. What's the reason for the amount of staff that seem to be going on to modified duties, and what are the kind of reasons for it?
I mean, there'll be any number of reasons that, you know, you will go through a programme. We have a process called SCOPE, which will identify those that are modified, and that will be where that data comes from, I assume. There can be, I mean, there can literally be any number of reasons. It could be injury, absence, you know, something else that's going on in your world. There, I know for a fact that there is a great deal of work ongoing at the moment to identify and scrutinise is probably the correct word, I think, you know, those who are shown as being on modified duties to see whether or not, you know, those modifications are still relevant and appropriate. Because there should be a review period built into this, and I think that's one aspect of it that has slipped over the years. The Chief Constable is very clear and has been about protecting the front line, and I absolutely believe that, as I've said. But there is a consequence of that as well from my colleagues who, you know, all of a sudden feel, and this is a byproduct of it, and I'm not necessarily saying that it's, you know, a preventative one, but this situation where they have been, for example, allowed to have modifications that are now being questioned, that has an impact. Again, it comes down to how we ask those questions and the delivery and the reactions that we get from them. But, I mean, it'd be difficult to quantify how you end up on modified duties because there are so many potential options, but it's work ongoing, I've got no doubt about that, to try and reduce those numbers because there are clearly issues for the organisation with that number of modified duties in the sense that we cannot bring those officers potentially back to the front line to allow that to be supported.
Would everybody who's on modified duties be unable to carry out full operational duties?
No, maybe Suzanne would be better. She'd have more detail about that than I would. But
yeah, so happy to come in if that's okay. Yeah. So people can be marked deployable and non-deployable. So I think the language is really important here. We will have people who are modified because of a physical ailment or a psychological ailment who are still deployable with restrictions. For instance, if you're on certain medications, you can't maybe work a night shift, but you're still out there doing your front-facing role. However, some people, due to their characteristics of their illness or their injury, can't be deployed in a role because they can't deal with the public, they can't make quick decisions, they can't carry their PPE because of a physical, you know, inability to do so. So they are put into roles that those skills are not required. So I think for me, the service needs to be really clear about what deployable assets do we need to deliver the service that the public of Scotland expect from us, and what are we able to deliver with what we have. Because if we continue to increase the numbers of non-deployable staff, what kind of service can we deliver? We've obviously got provision under the Equality Act that requires us to find roles for people as well if they've got a disability. So we have to be really alive to that because we have to, you know, make sure people are giving, you know, an appropriate employment where possible. But I think from a local policing lens, there are very few roles now in my division that I can put another adjusted officer into. So we now will potentially put them to a panel for discussion about where else in the service that their needs can be accommodated.
So how long can somebody stay in modified duties for?
So there's different options. So you can be adjusted long term. So you go modified to begin with. After 12 months, you're marked as adjusted. That could be for the remainder of your service because whatever is, you know, whatever has affected you may never change. So occupational health will give us some advice about how long that adjustment may require. Officers then have the option to stay adjusted, consider ill health retainment, or indeed consider ill health retirement if that is something that obviously is better for them.
I'm just thinking that what we're saying at the moment, we've got the lowest police numbers since 2007. There's reports that 945 are able to be retired before next summer. So what are your views on the current staffing levels and Are we doing enough then to deal with people that are on modified duties? Is it sustainable? Because the more, if you've got one person in modified duties and then somebody else comes in with the same issues, you could end up with a whole police force that are in modified duties, which means they're not able to get out and do frontline duties.
Yeah, and I think that's my sort of position around we need to be really clear on what deployable assets we need, and with what we've got, what can we do? And we need to be really clear on what are we able to deliver with the deployable assets that we've got. And if we're not going to have deployable staff, what does that mean for our delivery for policing across Scotland?
Ben McPherson, followed by Russell Finlay.
Thank you, Convener. Just on that point, just briefly, I think, just for clarity, there are a great number of police officers, aren't there, who are physically or otherwise disabled, who are deployable assets and are able to do great work in the community and do so on a daily basis.
Absolutely. People who have got restrictions on their duties, as I've already touched on, by example of medication, who are out there doing frontline, you know, in uniforms, serving the public. But there are a number of people who, due to their ailments, are unable to do that.
Thank you. I just thought that was an important point of clarity. Yeah. Police Scotland's submission to us talks about how a workforce survey has been undertaken this summer, and we await the results of that, and that'll be interesting and important, and give us a refreshed empirical base. But just based on my anecdotal engagement, which, similar to trade union representatives, people who come to me in my constituency, it's normally when there's a time of challenge. But I just wondered if you could touch on how interaction with other services is still affecting the demand, because I know, for example, that when officers are having to accompany people to adult mental health services and the waiting times that often occur when that's happening has both an effect on the capacity of the service to then go out and engage in other cases and other incidents, but also is a frustrating process for officers having to wait hours in order to make sure they fulfil their duty of care. I wondered how much that is still an issue. And you talked about rest, obviously extremely important, and shifts and that scheduling challenge. You know, how much are other entities in our society, whether it's sporting activities, cultural activities, where I know in this city a lot of officers leave gets cancelled in order for them to cover these events. You know, how much are these organisations and businesses thinking about the police and the capacity of the police to safely be part of these events, and the effect that has on the demand, the, you know, increasing demand profile of officers in our country?
Thank you. To address the first point around, you know, the police response to, you know, health matters, if we're going to simplify it, it's been identified as a priority for the Chief Constable. It's certainly the biggest issue that I believe, as the Chair of the SPF, that impacts on our ability to deliver policing across Scotland, and by consequence, the impact on our staff. The information that we have when we talk to operational sergeants and inspectors is that the demand can, you know, take up to 60 or 70% of their operational capacity every day, and that is through, as you've alluded to, you know, waiting in hospital A&E rooms or in people's living rooms waiting for a call from a mental health practitioner. There is a great deal of work ongoing within the service to address this. I'm part of it, you know, at a board level myself, and there have been some real improvements very recently, in fact, with, you know, the fact that we now have access to all of the services on, you know, police officers' handheld devices. That is a real step forward. There are pockets of practice across the country. You know, there's one on the go in Lanarkshire at the moment where, you know, there are piloting a programme. It's happened up in D Division as well. But what we don't have is a situation where the 25.5-hour double crewed units sitting with somebody in A&E has happened in that pilot area in Lanarkshire have been, you know, removed from our policing profile yet. We still have the situation where most of the work is ongoing strategically. And when I talk to officers, as I do at operational level, there is really no change to the way that we are policing the mental health or the health demand across Scotland at the moment. If we are going to successfully change not only our ability to deliver the basics of policing in this country, but and with the knock-on impacts to our staff and their health and well-being, to the recruitment and retention that we have within this organisation. This is very much work that has to change. Now, the service has been to Liverpool. We've looked at the right care, right person approach from the Met and Humberside. And I know that they say the legislation prevents us from taking that approach in Scotland. We're going to go for a sort of hybrid model to address the challenges and the impacts on policing. But if the question is it still a significant issue, then it absolutely is. Probably, in my opinion, the most significant issue that affects policing in Scotland at the moment. And there is no conversation that I have that in my mind somehow doesn't come back to this area as a potential cause.
Just for clarity and completeness, could you write to the committee just on why the legislation here in Scotland doesn't allow us to do that? Do things in the same way that has been examined elsewhere. And just our partners, whether it's NHS, local authorities or otherwise, are they playing their part effectively and proactively enough in order to help?
There's been a huge amount of engagement. You know, you have a difficulty with one police service and 14 health boards, herd the cats, to make sure that we've got one process. And that, I think, is manifest in the areas across the country where, things work well and where things aren't happening, My question that has never really been answered when I, speak to them is, what is your motivation to change your processes if you accept that, the health boards are already broken, they're under extreme pressure? By bringing in the sort of change that I believe needs to happen for us to allow to deliver policing, that will only increase the workloads of health boards. But that is a challenge that we have to address and work with, people. The situation that Suzanne and I discussed during the riots recently in Dundee, where the police just ended up taking, people who are suffering a mental health crisis to the facility in Dundee and leaving them there because we just simply didn't have the resource to deal with them. That process is, in effect, where I think we need to get to in policing, across the country. And the consequence of it was that you had them calling the control room saying, why are you doing this? Because we had no option, And it's that initial part of the process, that risk aversion, that still really impacts on our ability to deliver policing. And the way that we can deal with that is to have clear strategic direction from the Chief Constable that says, and you can't be totally prescriptive about this because of the situations we're dealing with, but we need to have confidence, and first and second line managers across Scotland have to have confidence that if they're risk positive in the decisions that they make, that the PIRC will buy into what they've done, subject to the appropriate scrutiny, of course, that the service will, that professional standards won't come chasing them because they have made a risk-positive decision. And when I spoke to the Chief the other day, I was very clear that that confidence does not exist yet in Police Scotland and it needs to.
Very interesting. Thank you.
For me, it's the provision, around criminal justice and health. It's the gaps in the provision in criminal justice and health and social care that have the police leaning into spaces that they shouldn't be in, which then creates that extra demand when our focus should be elsewhere, doing what the public expect us to do, which is, guard, watch and patrol to some degree, but being visible in our local communities, that early intervention and prevention in that criminal justice space to actually negate the need for the justice process to take heed. But because we're filling in gaps and other organisations, the way they deal with things, where, the court citations, for instance, 90-odd% of those you're witness for court and you're not you're not required to go. So meanwhile, you've had your rest days cancelled, you've had your shift partner adjusted, and you've somehow had to get somebody to fix your caring responsibilities. And the day before, you get told you're not required, but our workforce agreement doesn't allow us to put you back on your night shift. So you're then filling that with overtime, cancelling other people's rest days, all of those things, because the criminal justice system is not slick enough to work with how we operate. So we need to be better connected. The conversations are ongoing. The Chief has made our commitment really, really clear in that space. And we just need to get better at other services understanding the implications of their decisions on how our operating model works.
Thank you. Anything you want to add?
I would speak to the fact that it's a great strength of our members that it's a vocation to them, that they will not leave the most vulnerable in society exposed. But it's the police service that are absorbing these vulnerabilities from other organisations that colleagues have spoken about, the NHS, the Crown Prosecution Service, the Chief Constable and the SP Board do not have the ability to get them to fix their house before we can address that problem. we always talk about the police being the last resort, and we absolutely are, and we won't leave people vulnerable. So it will continue to be absorbed by officers and staff until other areas of the public sector are addressed.
And that was all very helpful. Did any of you want to touch on the impact of regular events and major events just on the demand?
I'm happy to do that. So yeah. I'm a silver and a gold commander, so events are a really big commitment across Scotland. You know, whether it's football, you know, whether it's you know, potentially the Commonwealth Games coming over the horizon, you know, there's a huge police footprint and all of that. So it's not only the event itself, it's the significant planning that goes in ahead of that, the disruption to officer shifts because we have to give them, you know, notice periods, etc. And how to absorb that when you're already running, you know, under your operating model is really, really difficult. So officers are regularly getting rest days cancelled, getting paid overtime for events. And yes, there is a cost recovery to some degree, but it's only certain parts of the event that we can cost recover for. And we will obviously potentially put out a wider police footprint to some of the events due to the volume of people travelling in and out of cities to some of the significant events. So it's a really busy landscape for us. We are definitely moving into that risk positive space around events, understanding is there a value for the police being present and is there the significant threat, risk and harm that's a need for us to be there. And if not, we've got, you know, some really good event companies that come across Scotland to deliver events. You know, should we be replicating what happens elsewhere in the UK, that they're allowed to run their event without a police presence, potentially? And we're moving into that space as we get commander comfort and we get that confidence that people are able to deliver safe events without the need for police to be present.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Russell Findlay and then Fulton MacGregor.
Thanks, Convener. The committee's heard evidence from suspended officers who say they were isolated, ostracised and kept in the dark over prolonged periods of time. This has resulted in poor mental health, attempted suicides and even suicides. Do you think enough has been done to ensure their welfare? And that's probably one for David.
I think there's probably a two-part answer to that. From my own organisation, you know, we have a process where we will engage with suspended officers. You know, one of our procedures is that we will always meet them at the point of suspension to, you know, to talk through, you know, what is likely to happen, the benefit of experiences that we have in the past. And we will maintain that contact with them, largely based on their own needs rather than us phoning every week, for example, because that can become a really negative thing. Which takes me to some of the feedback that we receive from officers about that almost, and I don't like the phrase, but box-ticking element of contact, if you like. So, hello, it's your sergeant or whatever. There's really nothing to say other than discussing the weather or whatever. The feelings of isolation are absolutely real. You've gone from a complete structure within your life, you know, getting up to go to work your shifts, whatever, and that is all of a sudden removed from you. I've never been in that situation myself, but from speaking to many of those who have, it is an absolute issue, and again, one where I think we need to have more engagement with those officers to ensure their welfare, because a simple phone call on a regular four-week period simply isn't doing it. The suspensions will be reviewed by the service every 28 days, so if the circumstances have changed, there is potential for, you know, the suspension to be lifted or that officer to be moved on to restricted duties. But the reality is that whilst I'm aware of that happening, it's by far the exception rather than the rule, and we do have officers who have been suspended for many years within the organisation.
Police Scotland's submission to the committee, it says, and I quote, "We take steps to ensure that welfare provisions are in place and investigations are concluded as quickly as possible." Is that a fair assessment?
I mean, in some respects, so with the service's hand, you know, if that officer is subject to a criminal investigation and it's sitting with the Crown, I can think of no example where that suspension has been reviewed whilst that Crown investigation is ongoing, and very few where the decision to move that officer from suspension to restriction has taken place once that process is finished, although I accept it does happen. So that kind of takes me back to the point of, you know, the time, you know, the number of years in some cases that officers can, you know, can be suspended for, with an obvious impact on their health, but also the public purse as well.
Okay. How many hours typically would one of your members work? Is there a typical weekly?
Officers?
Yeah.
I mean, we're contracted for 40 hours a week. The discussion at the board about providing a service with overtime because of what we don't have in budgeted establishment, you know, there'll be very few operational police officers, and I can't give you an exact number. I wasn't prepared for the question in that depth, but I would think there'll be very, very few operational officers across Scotland who work 40 hours per week. And that will be different, and that there's a real distinction throughout all of this between frontline operational officers and those who are not, you know, so are carrying out equally valuable work but in a back office function. I would suspect some of them may well end up, you know, doing the sort of regulated hours, but
it wouldn't be unusual for your members to typically work more than 40 hours a week.
I would say it was absolutely the reality.
Aye, okay. One of the reasons I ask is in the submission from ASPS, Suzanne, you say that 97% of your members work over 40 hours per week. Now, I suppose the difference being the salary bands for superintendents and chief super start at 79k and go up to over £106,000. So is that a complaint that your members work, 97% of them work over 40 hours a week?
I think it's just a recognition of the role and the portfolios that we all carry, that we, you know, we work office hours, you know, generally Monday to Friday, 8 to 4, but we've all got extra commitments on top of that. Most of us have got specialisms, you know, whether it's an event commander, silver or gold, or indeed firearms commander. So we all do additional responsibilities in respect of those roles. I was on call last night for the north and east of Scotland. So despite working my day shift yesterday, you know, you get numerous calls throughout the evening, and again, first thing this morning, because things happen, you know, which is part of your on-call capability, which I absolutely understand. But you are regularly, potentially, you're working in the sense that you're reading papers because you're preparing for the next day. You're going into multiple forums because your portfolio is generally quite vast at the superintendent ranks. You know, whether you're carrying, you know, significant budgetary responsibility, you're leading on, you know, stuff in your estates field, you know, my people oversight, you know, all of that requires quite a bit of, you know, knowledge and information, which takes time to do when your day job is generally jumping in and out of meetings to, you know, to get on, you know, to get the day job done almost.
No.
Just bring in David. I think you're...
Sorry, yeah.
Just one point on that, thank you. What I think is missing from this, you know, if you accept that officers work overtime, and there's been some figures recently about the vast amounts of money annually that cops are making in overtime, what is missing is the impact on their health and their well-being by accruing that amount of extra work. And that is something that, again, if we're going to meaningfully tackle the well-being and welfare of our officers, has to be part of the solution, because what's happening is the resourcing units are looking for a name and a number that they can fill a particular vacancy with for whatever, football or whatever it happens to be. There is no cognizance taken of how much that officer has worked in leading up to that point or the impact that it potentially has on them. The two areas of business are not linked, and that's somewhere I believe that we have to go if we're going to really, you know, deal with these issues, because they exist.
Absolutely. Now, my colleague Sharon Dowie had already mentioned officer numbers being at their lowest that they've been in 17 years. So we've got all these initiatives, we've got all this new training, we've got all this goodwill from the top down to try and address what we're here to talk about, which is officer mental health. But is the reality not that due to the increased pressures that officers are inevitably going to experience, that a lot of that will count for nothing and you're effectively running to stand still?
So the question is yes. You know, we have, I don't have the exact figure, but I think the service would say that we're about 400 under establishment at the moment. And we shouldn't forget that that is a consequence of a recruitment freeze from September through to March this year. That training embargo has an impact. We cannot, and I know the government will talk about record numbers of recruitment this year, and that is a fact, but what it doesn't say is that more officers are leaving our organisation every month than it's possible for us to recruit. So in reality, the number is always on a downward scale at the moment, and what that clearly does, when you consider that the demand doesn't go away, it increases the pressure on those who remain.
It goes back to the point you made about overtime. With fewer and fewer officers, there'll be an expectation, almost an obligation, to do overtime. And that could potentially add to their stress.
Well, and you can be ordered to do overtime.
Yeah.
You know that you don't have the choice in certain circumstances. And all of these things manifest themselves in pressure. You know, we're just human at the end of the day. And what we are seeing is increasing numbers of people who either leave the organisation because they can't deal with it, or go off sick or onto modified duties because the consequences of trying to do the best for the people of Scotland, you know.
Yeah, absolutely.
I was just going to bring in maybe David on, if you wanted to kind of comment on any of the points that Russell has been...
Well, for police staff, there isn't any obligation to do overtime, but I know that a number of members in particular frontline areas that are recognised with HMICS's definition of frontline, my members in the service centres and the control rooms, the resolution teams and the custody suites will certainly be doing overtime. To do that, whether they'll take payment for that or whether they'll just accrue time. And of course, that has the same challenge on their well-being if they can, you know, they can't take that time or they're not taking the required rest between shifts, they will wear out.
Thank you. One more very quick one. It was something specific in the SPF submission to the committee. It said there was an offer who'd been seconded to A Division, which is Ayrshire, I believe, in a suicide prevention role, but they're no longer in that role. Do you know why not?
Just A Division is Aberdeen up in the northeast of Scotland.
Yeah,
so right. Legacy kind of grumping for.
Right.
As I understand from speaking to that officer, it was decided that the post, you know, the officer was better used elsewhere. But when I look at the definition that was submitted, it seems to me that, you know, those three or four lines that officer provided me are exactly what we need in the organisation at the moment. And that attitude and those processes replicated across Scotland could have a real impact in, you know, what we're talking about, but not from that sad point of completed suicide, but all the way back to the interventions that we're talking about in that preventative space as well.
Ball analogy.
It's a very simple one, but no one will forget it, I don't think.
No, absolutely.
Fulton McGregor, followed by Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. One of the things when we've been, as the Convener said at the start, we've been looking at this on committee for a while, and one of the things that's always struck me is that, and it's been referred to already today, is that the police deal with almost everything. You deal with the really most difficult situations, and I know some of that's in the context of plugging gaps of other services, which has been covered, but in any case, the police are always there if it's, you know, deaths, assaults, incidents involving children, all sorts of the most horrific stuff that we can think of, the police are first there. So I wanted to ask about thresholds. If a police officer's out dealing with something, is there a particular threshold that you have, the individual departments have a threshold? So I guess what I'm thinking, the examples I'm thinking ahead of, if a police officer has to go out and deal with, say, a really difficult child protection issue, maybe alongside social work or other services, do they get a debriefing after that? Or do they just go on to do something else and are perhaps then dealing with maybe a really difficult mental health situation for an individual? I guess what I'm getting at is there thresholds that kick in to say, right, no, you need to come in for a briefing and you don't do anything else for the rest of the day? Does that question make sense? You're nodding, Suzanne, so I'll come with you first. Don't nod, Cyril.
No, I'm nodding because it probably resonates with me just about, I suppose, why a lot of people are attracted to join the police, because of the sheer variety of, you know, what could occur in your, you know, 10-hour day. So for me, there isn't a threshold as in you only deal with two things, five things, you only go to two deaths. That doesn't exist. But what the expectation is from line management is there is that debrief, you know, that cross-check, are you okay? All of those things I've experienced that myself in, you know, various roles when someone has done that. The real challenge just now is around the supervisory ratios and having leaders and supervisors in the right places to do that conversation and have that conversation. Because as we get slightly thinner on the ground, there's less of those people able to do that intervention point, as David's already touched on today. We regularly record, you know, near misses in respect to physical injury. But what we don't do, or we don't have a mechanism currently about recording a near miss for trauma, you know, and again, I don't know if that's, you know, something that's even practical to do, because it, particularly when you read comments from officers who are maybe going through the ill health retirement route, there's quite often those events that they will recall in their submissions about the times where they believe that their trauma has begun, and then obviously what has then happened thereafter. So you do wonder if there's room around, you know, should we be doing something to record trauma? But I don't know how we do that. And I'm not sure you always recognise that that event was the traumatic one, often till some time after, because I think we all react differently to trauma. And I think we've spoken about the drip-drip effect a few times. And maybe it's not that thing. Maybe it's the thing that comes 2 or 3 years after. I'm not sure if I've answered your question, but hopefully.
No, that was good. David, would you want to come in?
Thank you. I think the one word that would describe our job is relentless. You know, what you've described would be, you know, a very good way of doing business. You know, and I'll talk mainly from an operational policing lens, but the reality is that the officers out there performing this function because of the demand, because of the numbers, do not have that opportunity to decompress at the end of incidents. And that link in with supervisors, you know, that we've spoken about TRIM and how that can come from somebody completely random who's got no knowledge of your, you know, previous life in the police. this is part of the challenge, and COPS talk to us about this all the time, you know, and when you look at other agencies, they will have, whether you want to call them hot debriefs or, you know, slower time opportunities to discuss and decompress and talk through the challenges of what you've just been to. That doesn't happen in the police. And is a real issue. And again, it's part of the solution that we need to get to providing for better well-being in the organisation.
Well, you've been on to start to answer my next question, because I was going to actually ask whose responsibility is it to initiate debriefs or slow time or whatever you referred to as? Is it the management or is it the individual officer themselves? And what would happen in a situation, I guess, if an officer said, you know, I've been dealing with a really difficult situation, someone on a death was an example, I don't want to go out in anything else that's potentially difficult or traumatic later this afternoon, what sort of response would that officer get from management?
I mean, there's two aspects to that. There's the sort of proactive individual, you know, approach to a supervisor, and I've got no doubt that if that did happen, you know, you would be dealt with, you know. There is a cultural issue here that means that, you know, huge numbers of police officers are not comfortable doing that, and they take the lead from their sergeant, for example. So if a team has been at an incident and the sergeant doesn't accept trim, you know, the information that we have would show that it's very unlikely that those constables in that same team are going to as well. The supervisory aspect of that, the big challenge here is, as we have discussed, the supervisors are largely not there. You know, you might have had five teams with five sergeants before, you might have five teams with one now. If they are not on the same shift as you, your days off are different, you might not see that person for a month at a time, you know. So that link with the first line manager, which is so important in our organisation, not only for ourselves but our ability to do policing, is in some areas of Scotland, you know, just absolutely missing. And that impacts on exactly the, you know, the point that you're making in your question.
David, are you on to come in?
Yeah, absolutely. I deal with members also in Police Scotland and the SPA Forensic Services. We've spoken to SPA Forensic Services about the forensic scene examiners that go out to scene after scene and exposed to sometimes very horrendous sites. And through their tasking unit, they've taken that advice on looking at how they would take people. But in other areas, for staff, say you're taking calls that are traumatic, or you're exposed to sensitive images, or even some of our document preparation staff who are listening to audio recordings, you know, very disturbing events that have been recorded. I don't feel that we do have that there. I've seen it handled by team leaders and managers on an individual basis very positively. In other places, I've seen it, you know, completely lax. So there isn't a standard for it, you know, coming from the organisation to actually say, please consider that, you know, and taking someone aside and giving them some time after they've been exposed to something.
Do you think that other organisations or services treat trauma, vicarious trauma, impact trauma at the time better than the police, or do you think there's lessons that can be learned there? Not that we're here to talk about other services, because there's probably lots of concerns about those as well, but do you think there is things that police could bring in?
We did take some feedback from some of our members who either had family or knowledge of things in the NHS where they had a traffic light system of, you've had a red incident, so now you don't go out to anything that's not categorised as green or amber, you know, it's like a traffic light system. And I think something like that probably would help in these areas.
I guess the other side of that is the amount of incidents the police are dealing with are just are so hard. One more order.
We'll bring Pauline McNeill in, and then I'll come back to you if there's time. Thank you. Pauline McNeill.
Good morning. I found that a very helpful line of questioning by Philip McGregor, because I think it kind of gets to the heart of what I think I'm hearing this morning about the job of being a frontline police officer. My questions to you, David Threadgold. So you said that there isn't always the opportunity to decompress after difficult situations. So, for example, so if the police officers were dealing with a very violent situation and they had to use their batons or sprays or whatever, or was a difficult, is there no standard then response to that when they return back from that incident? There's no standard response.
I mean, specifically about the use of baton, there would be, you know, process, an administrative one to record what, you know, had happened, and there is an opportunity through, you know, the officer safety trainers that exist to, you know, proactively go back to those officers. I think it was described as if there was something unusual, but the word that was used there by Mr. McGregor was time. You know, the most important thing that you can give people is time, and that is what we don't have in this organisation. So I mean, the reality is that, you know, you will go back, you will go to a serious road accident, you will come back to the station, you will be sent to something else. The demand from the control room and those in C3 is relentless. We have situations where, you know, the calls that cannot be dealt with at the end of a shift are cut and pasted onto the duty sergeant's desk for that area. So before you even start, you have a list of calls that require your attention, which immediately focuses your attention on that and takes it away from your people. So the suggestion that, you know, we have those opportunities, it would take a very strong supervisor to say to the control room, we're not doing that anymore because I have to sit with my team. And an example that was given to me, we talk about wellbeing, we talk about welfare as a priority. And if you were to look at the diaries of those who are in, you know, management positions within the organisation, how much of that diary time would be set aside for wellbeing and welfare, and I would wager it would be nothing, if very little at all. And that is a really simple but powerful example of how we are not dealing with our staff particularly well, in my opinion.
So do you think there needs to be something standardised?
It's difficult to standardise our role, I think, because it is so spontaneous, but we have to have a culture and a relationship between our officers and their supervisors that allows for these things to take place. Now, that is difficult because of the demand that we have, but if we're meaningfully going to take the words from these pages and turn them into reality for cops, to prevent me from having to listen to dozens and dozens of testimonies, you know, thousands of pieces of feedback that say how this is not going well, that is what my role is in this organisation, to try and make sure that we change what we're doing for the better. And as I've said, I believe the Chief has got the same vision as I do, but the reality is something different. And some of the responses from Police Scotland about how we're going to do that, I think, you know, with everyone's permission, you know, need to be addressed here, because they are not going to change, in my opinion, the culture that we have, and they're not going to impact on police officers across Scotland just simply because of the examples that have been given.
Has the reduction in police officer numbers exacerbated that situation you describe?
Well, I think that it's inevitable, but, you know, all we would do if we had, you know, another 10,000 police officers at the moment would be to increase the demand on them. We're never going to finish policing, you know. It's not possible we can service the demand entirely. What we have to do is accept that it is unlikely we're going to have an increased budget establishment or a massively increased budget, and become more efficient within our own organisation to deal with what we do have and how we deploy those officers and staff to service the communities across Scotland. And we're some way yet away from dealing with that effectively.
You said to my colleague Ben McPherson about positive risk, and you said that that confidence does not yet exist amongst police officers. Why do you think that is?
Well, it's very simple. There's the unknown, the perception amongst first and second line managers that the organisation doesn't fully support them. You know, the fear for their pensions, for their ability to pay their mortgage, for their liberty in some cases, and these are real challenges that are ingrained at the moment in the first and second line manager cadre across the organisation. I've got absolutely no doubt about that. And the change comes from the top, where the Chief can provide us with that strategic direction to allow us to become more risk positive. And there are examples of where, you know, for example, if there's been a police contact death and the PIRC have been involved, where the PIRC are absolutely behind the decisions that have been made by the police officers and there is no issue for them. But the perception across the country is that that is not the case, and it is absolutely preventing my colleagues at that level from making the type of decisions that I would expect, but also those in the public across Scotland would expect.
The Prison Inspectorate, Craig Naylor, said to the committee some time ago in this very inquiry, which I think is a similar issue to what you're describing, is that police officers are asked to do difficult things, difficult tasks, whether it's use of firearms or then if they're not backed up by senior officers, that they feel vulnerable to that. Is that what you're talking about? Is it the same issue?
Exactly that. Police officers, in my experience, have got no problem making difficult decisions at all, but they're not doing it because they don't feel that the support is there through the organisation, and that comes through training of first-line managers and upwards. And those that are making more strategic and tactical decisions, giving those people the confidence to make those decisions. And there is a key area that is missing at the moment, and I've discussed it with the Chief many times. And the reality is that it is a priority for her, but I spoke to her about this, and I'll say this publicly. The perception on the front line at the moment is that nothing has changed really since she started, and there is still that absolute risk aversion, you know, that reluctance to make decisions that are, when you look at it objectively, common sense, and the impact is we get tied up for countless hours at a time across Scotland. We can't provide a service. We end up with proportionate response to crime models, which are a direct consequence of our inability to do the basics of policing, in my opinion.
Thanks. You said in your submission that there was very mixed feedback regarding the introduction of the duty modifications posting panel within the service. Could you just explain to the committee what the duty modifications posting panel is?
Yeah, Suzanne will probably do this better than me, but I'll have a go.
I'm happy to do that. So we've touched on today around having officers who are modified or adjusted. So if a division can't absorb that person because we don't have a post that's suitable for their needs, then we've got an opportunity to put a briefing paper in detailing the circumstances, detailing the things we've tried to do locally, and it goes into the duty modification panel for consideration of an alternate posting. So at that point in time, there's a discussion about the circumstances, the options, whether it should be capability, whether it should be ill health retirement, whether it should be ill health retainment, or indeed whether or not there's a post. For instance, if someone can't wear their PPE, then they may go find themselves in a control room post. So they're still public-facing, delivering in a front service, but they're not out there in a public-facing setting. It's done, over computers and telephones and such like, but their police officer skills are still being utilised. So that duty modification panel, it's quite new. It's only run a couple of times, and we're all probably just, we've had no training in actually what we're going to do, so we're all trying to just, I suppose, navigate our way through that. And I think for me, one of the really important aspects is a conversation with the officer who may be affected by the move towards that modification as to why we're doing that and the purpose of that, because if you don't get that bit right, it can potentially undermine the whole process because you'll lose the confidence of the officer. But the purpose of that is about making sure we're using their skills in an area where that skill set can be absorbed and allows you to then free up a post in your local policing environment for somebody who's operationally fit.
Thank you.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, thank you. Just a final question. Probably to you, David Treadgold. In the Police Scotland submission, they say that Autumn Police Scotland will publish a long-term vision for the service and a three-year plan to deliver the next wave of policing reform. A thriving workforce is a central ambition in that work. Given what you've said, have you got concerns about this plan, or is it all interwoven into the same thing about policing reform?
The success of any plan is only moving it from the page to the reality. Some of the things that are in here that I would just like to highlight, without being destructive in the comments that I'm about to make, the wellbeing champions, for example, as part of the submission is often spoke about publicly as part of the solution. The information that we have is that that programme has achieved little, if anything, and there are a number of reasons for that, that officers just do not buy into it because it's not part of our culture. It's got the potential to achieve stuff, but at the moment it absolutely doesn't. When we talk about lifelines, this is a brilliant product, but if you look at the numbers who have been exposed to it, and this comes back to the HMICS report when we're looking at a sort of corporate approach to this, how are we going to get to a situation where every officer and member of staff in Scotland has received this lifelines training? Because you extend in your mind the way that the service is talking about doing it through the utilisation of officers and staff to deliver it. That takes a resource away from the front line. Is there a better way of doing that in the sense that we could bring people in to deliver that training for us? There is a time and an investment there. The stuff about TIPTI, which is a Police Care UK led programme, we have trained people to deliver that across Scotland, but at the moment, and I sit as a trustee of that charity, that programme has been suspended. It's going through a complete review at the moment, so I don't believe that we should base our potential strategy upon things that might never happen or that are having really no impact whatsoever across the organisation, or limited impact, as good as that might be, for those who happen to work in back office functions or in the central belt, for example. There should be no difference to what you receive as an officer for support, whether you work in Orkney or Aberdeen or Glasgow, but that is the situation that we have at the moment. So there is real positivity in the document, but with all the challenges that we've spoken about already, I think the delivery will be key, and the investment in first and second line managers is absolutely critical to its success.
Thank you.
Thank you. We're just about up to time, but one question I did want to come in on was in relation to body-worn cameras. So obviously, we're aware that there's been a delay in terms of the rollout of body-worn cameras. I'm just interested in your sort of your view on that. So I'll come to David and then Suzanne.
I think what wasn't helpful was that the Chief Constable said that these cameras were going to be rolled out in late summer of 2024. That gave officers an expectation that it would be, which is clearly now not going to be the case. The organisation has now said that we're looking towards the end of March for the rollout of them. Again, I'm not heavily involved in the project team, but you know, I will be pleased if that happens, clearly for all the reasons that body-worn video is an absolute benefit to officers. The longer that it goes on without them, there's a real danger in my mind that we turn what is a really positive aspect of policing into a negative, because the officers are just continually saying to me, you know, when is this happening? But the benefits are clear in terms of, you know, interactions with the public, reduced complaints, reduced assaults. So the sooner we have it, the better. And I do accept that it's absolutely right that when it eventually comes and it will go to Suzanne's division first and roll out from there, that it works. But there are absolute challenges with the infrastructure within Police Scotland's buildings in terms of getting the technology in to deal with it. The interface between the street desk, the project that will be the sort of middle person in this project, and the Crown Office is a real challenge. What I've said is that, you know, our conference is at towards the end of March next year. I hope that I am not standing there saying that we still do not have body-worn video cameras, but I will be pleased if we do. Thank you.
Suzanne, very quickly, if there's anything you want to add.
Yeah, just, you know, we're going to be the pilot division, or not necessarily the pilot division, we're going to be the first division to receive body-worn video, so delighted with that, because we've already got desks, we're already piloting summary case management, so it's going to be that real transition from pavement to courtroom, which will not only speed up justice for officers, but actually ultimately members of the public who are, you know, coming to our attention. So for me, Dave's touched on it, there's real challenges around the IT infrastructure around that, but not unanticipated. You know, we've got two different companies supplying us with products, so they need to speak to one another. But there is an absolute commitment from the service to get that bit right, to take out any human inefficiencies in that process. So when it is delivered, it's as efficient as it possibly can be, and it will hopefully reap the benefits that we've already touched on today. But we're looking forward to it coming next year.
Yeah. OK. And a very super small question from Russell.
Cameras, other than to note that in 2012, Grampian Police were the first to pilot these, so it's nice to see that after all these years they'll be returning there operationally. I was going to ask about lifelines, David, that you referred to. Over 1,000 officers and staff have attended this training, and you talked positively about it. Who provides that training? And it also says at the bottom of the submission from Police Scotland, they're moving towards having 110 officers and staff within the organisation who can facilitate it. So it's clearly going to be an ongoing thing. Do you know who provides that training?
It's done through the NHS down in Edinburgh, the River Centre, I understand.
Right.
You know, it is great. The officers and staff distinction is an important one for, you know, probably Mr. Malcolm and myself to understand the impact that it will have on police officers. But if we're looking to get to a point where, as I say, we have a consistent product to help our staff, you know, lifelines may be part of the solution, but without, you know, a significant amount of investment, and I don't even know whether they could facilitate it, even if we did, there are challenges there, you know.
It's confusing me. We've got lifelines, we've got VivUp, we've got a new occupational health contract, we've got TRIM, we've got pilot schemes in different parts of the force. It just a bit, seems a bit inconsistent, a bit of a patchwork quilt.
I agree.
Yeah, OK. Thank you.
OK, I will have to close the session there. Thank you very much. That's been a very useful insight and update. So thank you for your evidence this morning, and we'll just have a short suspension to allow for a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. Thank you very much, members. So our second panel today consists of senior representatives of Police Scotland, and I'm very pleased to welcome Joe Farrell, Chief Constable, Katie Miller, Director of People and Development, and Alan Spears, Deputy Chief Constable with People and Professionalism at Police Scotland. So welcome to you all, and I intend to allow around 60 minutes for this session. So can I start off by inviting the Chief Constable to make a short opening statement? Chief Constable.
Good morning. Thank you. The invitation today is very timely. As you're aware, yesterday was World Suicide Prevention Day. So I welcome the opportunity to provide the committee with assurance on the work both myself and my team are driving to support our people's safety and wellbeing. When I took up the role of Chief Constable in Police Scotland last October, I made it clear that strengthening and protecting our front line was a central priority for me, and that hasn't changed. My career, which is over 30 years in policing, has been built on that commitment, and I have served on the front line of policing in a variety of roles, and I know just how challenging and rewarding that work is. Strengthening our front line is about maximising the number of officers in our communities while enhancing their capacity and capability to engage and respond to the needs of the public. It's about supporting, equipping and protecting those colleagues who provide such valuable service to the public. From answering a call for help in an emergency to being the first responder on a scene to providing a point of liaison for victims of crime and their families during investigations. And all of this places our people at moments of crisis and trauma on a daily basis. And we do not underestimate the impact that that has on our people. Later this month, I will be present to the Scottish Police Authority a long-term vision for Police Scotland and a three-year plan to begin to realise that vision. We committed last year that we would develop a new sustainable and affordable model of policing. This vision will drive the work. And I'm determined that we will simplify our approach to planning and focus relentlessly on delivery and prioritisation of what's important, and that a thriving workforce will be central to that vision. When I took up my role, I made commitments to our workforce that I would listen to them and work hard every day to improve their day-to-day experiences. That means making real progress with measures such as technology, body-worn video, enabling the sharing of digital evidence across the criminal justice system, working with our partners to improve the efficiency of that system, and being clearer on our role in relation to vulnerable people suffering mental health and other crises. As well as these measures, I'm committed to providing better support to individuals in their time of need, and we have invested to improve our employee assistance programme and our occupational health service. Our wellbeing action plan was published last month and has been shared with the committee. I've also committed that we will undertake an annual survey of our officers and staff to understand their experience and focus on improvement. Our most recent survey closed in late August, and I'm pleased that more than 50% of our workforce, that's 11,500 colleagues, responded to that survey. Lastly, I recognise the interest this committee has shown on the subject of officer and staff suicide. The death of any officer or staff member by suicide is deeply felt by family, friends and colleagues and people across Scotland, Police Scotland. Please be assured of the seriousness with which we take this issue. We are not complacent, and supporting colleagues on a personal and professional level is central to our long-term vision of a thriving workforce. Myself and my colleagues are happy to take any questions that the committee may have for us. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Chief Constable. So, as usual, I'll come in with the first question, and then I'll open it up to members. So you mentioned in your introductory remarks the long-term vision for the service and the three-year plan to deliver the next wave of policing reform, which is welcome. So I wonder if you can maybe just expand a little bit on how that piece of work will impact on officer and staff well-being, just to what extent that will be addressed in that work.
Thank you. So, as part of our vision, I've committed that one element of that is a thriving workforce. Now, that is in no way different to my comments when I took over the role of Chief Constable. The safety, well-being and focus around making sure our people are best placed and feel confident and well to do their role is central to the delivery of policing in Scotland. The changes that we've made over the last 12 months and moving forward are very much to move both into a space of investing in greater prevention, so that our staff are better supported and we can provide them with the support to enable to deal with issues that may be affecting them early and not get to a crisis position. And in addition to that, invest further in our occupational health, so where we have issues of trauma. And you all know, as we do, that policing and police officers and police staff face trauma on a daily basis. It is the nature of the role of policing. And what we've seen post the pandemic is both across the whole of society an increase in psychological issues. So policing is not unique, but we recognise our colleagues face trauma on a daily basis. So a focus around greater prevention and facilities through our occupational health and what we're calling our employee assistance programme to provide early help, ensuring, and I know the committee have touched on interventions such as trauma management, so TRIM, giving our supervisors, our sergeants, our inspectors, our police staff who are in leadership roles, the tools in which to be able to provide support to individuals. So those leadership behaviours and tools that people need, both in terms of driving a values-based organisation, but at the same time feeling confident to support a colleague who they see may be struggling and be able to have those early conversations and then through our investment being able to signpost and support them into the best help so that we prevent trauma and impact and therefore, you know, loss of ability for people to come to work. So that's been the approach to drive that thriving workforce.
Okay, thank you for that, Chief Constable. I'm glad you spoke about prevention, because certainly that was something that the previous panel spoke about, in particular David Threadgold from the Police Federation. So looking at that, the value and the importance in and around signs of change in somebody's mental well-being being picked up earlier in this preventative context is what I interpreted from that. But one of the things he spoke about within that was almost a sort of separation between operational officers out and about doing their job and their contact with immediate line managers, so invariably a sergeant. And he spoke of some concerns around the lack of contact that they have. So I wondered if, again, coming back to the reform programme, if that's something that will be considered within that piece of work.
Thank you. So I've talked about strengthening the front line of policing. What I've observed when taking up the role is that I felt that there was a lack of focus around numbers of officers on the front line, and that includes sergeants and inspectors, and that there needed to be a rebalance and a real focus around local policing. And I've made it my mission to hear firsthand from those officers and staff that are delivering on the front line, whether that's in response policing, community policing, detective roles, our custody staff, These are all roles that we as an executive are absolutely committed to ensuring are at the greatest strength that they can be at. And I've looked across some of our corporate functions, and while I in no way would say that individuals aren't working and they're not working hard, what I've seen and what I've changed is that shift in emphasis to the core role of policing on the front line and ensuring that those areas are prioritised. Are we there yet? Not yet, but it's absolutely my focus. I was in Inverness a couple of weeks ago at the 7 o'clock early turn briefing, listening firsthand to police officers, to sergeants, to inspectors, to custody staff. What are the challenges? What draws away capacity from the front line of policing across Scotland? And how do we as an executive improve that? And it's only by listening firsthand that you really get a sense, as you know, a sense of the stressors and a sense of the areas where we need to step in and shift some of the areas of business that don't entirely sit with policing, although we have a role, and areas that we are pushing lots of capacity, daily capacity into, that is drawing away from that delivery of that policing. So I want that front line of policing to be as strong and as large as it can be. And it's only through listening to people firsthand that you really get a sense of the issues that are affecting the ability to do that.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I'll bring in members now, and I'm going to start with Russell Finlay, then Rona Mackay.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Chief Constable. In your opening remarks, you said that more than 50% of staff had responded to the survey. Do you have any data available on their views on welfare issues? And if not, will the survey be published, and if so, when?
Yeah, thank you. So really pleased with the number of people that responded. So the survey asked questions over a range of areas, and wellbeing and welfare is one of them. Leadership, environment, also issues around training and development. So far wide-ranging survey. The survey's closed now, and we're in the process of analysing that data. And in answer to your question, at the end of the autumn, we'll be able to provide both the results of that within the organisation and then be able to act on them, and then to this committee, should you wish so. I mean, my plan is to carry out that survey on an annual basis. The reason for doing that is, if you say to me, well, how do you know the well-being and health of the organisation and your people is improving? Well, one way of demonstrating that is the response to the survey. So over and above doing that survey on an annual basis, at times throughout the year, we'll also be doing what we call a pulse survey, so taking a particular issue and asking colleagues what their thoughts and their feedback is in relation to those issues. So we're continually monitoring, both in relation to the data, but what do people actually feel?
Not annual.
No, it wasn't. No, we haven't done one for three years. I'm just asking. Yeah, 3 years.
So it'll not be annual. Okay, gotcha. We've heard a lot about the work that's been done, the initiatives that are taking place, and in no particular order. There's the Your Leadership Matters, there's Wellbeing Champions, there's Police Care UK, there's Act Don't React, there's Timelines, there's ThriveWise, there's Trim, there's VivUp, and there's a new occupational health contract. Now, that's confusing me. I dare say if you're a frontline police officer, you don't have the time to begin to get your head around what all that means. Is it not in danger of being overly complicated and it should be streamlined, or what are your views on that?
Thank you. So you're right. You've listed a number of approaches, a number of initiatives. Director Miller, on our behalf, early in the year, carried out a review of all of the offers, facilities, programmes that exist across welfare, wellbeing and leadership. And we will seek to rationalise and better signpost officers and staff, so that it's clear what the routes through. But what we have seen, particularly in relation to our new occupational health offering and our employee assistant programme, is high rates of take-up in relation to that, which is positive. That means people know how to access it. this will be an ongoing endeavour by all of us to ensure that wherever you are, whatever role you're in, you, your sergeant, your colleague, your peer knows how to access the best support that's available to us, and ensure that that extra investment that we've made is providing value for money and support to colleagues.
I was going to ask about those two contracts, because they're both new. The occupational health contract, that doesn't say in the submission who's providing that. Do you know who that is?
So the occupational health contract is with Optima.
Right, and it's FEVUP that provide the employee assistance programme.
Correct.
And that's a limited company based in Essex called SMEHCI. Now, it describes itself as an employee benefits programme. I'm just wondering what the terms of both those contracts are in terms of cost and duration, and critically, what kind of formal assessment is being conducted to see that they're A, effective, and B, value for money?
Thank you. I'm going to ask Director Miller to come in on the detail of those, but important that the committee hear that.
Yes, thank you. So as you rightly pointed out, they're both relatively new contracts to Police Scotland. So we're in early days in terms of the evaluation of contract performance, although we have provided some evidence of that, and I can talk to more of that. I think you rightly talked a little bit earlier about how confusing the landscape potentially could be for colleagues. And I think that that's been well-intentioned on Police Scotland's behalf. Through the HMICS audit and also the independent review, there are a number of recommendations. And what we've tried to do to that is to distill that into a new health and wellbeing action plan, which was submitted as part of our documentation. And within that, we've looked through three lenses. So we've looked through an undo lens, which is at the point of exposure. What is it that we have in place for staff and officers? We've looked at mitigate, so at the point of impact of exposure to harmful factors. Again, what's the support we have in place? And then we've looked at prevention. So it's those three lenses. And we've taken the opportunity to step back and think about how we reframe all of the work that's underway against that. With regards to both EAP and OcHealth, EAP, VivUp are a provider that I've worked with before in other organisations, but more so on the benefits platform side, as you've said. They're relatively new to EAP market, but for both of those contracts, they were about a year in the making in terms of the procurement, so it was very extensive. We had stakeholders, numerous stakeholders involved in that procurement. Specifically for EAP, what VivUp provide is an access platform that's much more digitally enabled than perhaps previous suppliers. So what that means is it's instant access to qualified health professionals. And that was one of the points of gaps that we were hearing from our staff, is that ability to be able to access perhaps more bespoke types of support, such as CBT or EMDR, so more specialist types of trauma-related counselling. Additionally, what we found through EAP particularly is that the types of issues that are coming forward, we're able to drill down much more into. So we're seeing anxiety, stress, low mood, depression, and family difficulties.
Ask how long are the contracts for?
So the contracts are, I believe, are 3 years plus one. Optima were in place beforehand, but with the new contract, we've enhanced the requirements of that contract. We have in place robust contract performance, and that will get reported up through SPA committee and board.
Thank you very much. Now, when I first raised the tragedy of police officer suicides, the committee was surprised and concerned that these weren't being recorded. They hadn't been quantified or measured in any way whatsoever. And then last year, an ACC came to the committee and told us that five officers had died over 3 years, and that had been based on a manual trawl, it was the exact quote, of the databases. And then today's submission, Police Scotland have said that there have been 20 suicides in the 11 years of Police Scotland's formation, and this data has come from National Records of Scotland. So it's really a two-point question. One is, how confident are you collectively of the accuracy of that number, and that being the sole source of where you're accruing this data? And the second one is, how many of these 20 officers' deaths were subject to fatal accident inquiries?
certainly answer the first part of that, and that's to say that we're 100% assured by the figure that has been submitted. We have put in place, subsequent to the last committee, a mechanism by where we can now hold that data in relation to officers or staff in relation to death from suicide. So 100% assurance on that. I'm going to pass, if I can, to Dep Spears in relation to the fatal accident.
Yeah, thank you. So in every instance where an unexplained death occurs in Scotland, the circumstances are reported to Crown Office and they're fully investigated. And in the circumstances, Mr Finlay, of those suicides over that period of time, they are all reported through Crown Office. Any decision around the instigation of a fatal accident inquiry is a matter for Crown, and it's something that's decided by the fatal investigation unit, and it's not something that we can determine whether that will take place. And the number of fatal accident inquiries you will see is fairly well publicised. To my knowledge, there are few instances in these circumstances where those deaths have led to fatal accident inquiries, but that probably is a question that would be better placed for colleagues within Crown.
Does Police Scotland know how many of those 20 tragic deaths have been subject to a fatal accident inquiry?
I don't have that information to hand, though.
No. Okay. Yeah, I mean, in England and Wales, there's statutory inquests in such circumstances. And my understanding of the 8 previous suicides that we spoke about, none of those had been subject of a fatal accident inquiry. And in some of those cases, there were potential contributory factors relating to workplace issues. And I just wonder whether there's a bit of a blind spot in respect of officers who have died in these circumstances. If there isn't a fatal accident inquiry, the potential that those issues are being missed and the lessons are not being learned from that.
So I think what we could give the committee assurance of is that in every instance there's a high level of reporting. It is confidential, it is recorded on our system, and we are looking at lessons to be learned. You will appreciate that the complexities around officer suicide and deaths is very, very difficult. Regrettably, the control around whether or not a fatal accident inquiry takes place is entirely out with our hands.
Thank you.
Okay. Rhona Mackay, then Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Chief Constable, you spoke earlier about the trauma and just due to the nature of the job, and there is evidence of a rise of psychological disorders. I'm not sure if you heard David Threadgold's evidence, but he spoke about training, lack of training and training difficulties, and the SPF submission to the committee suggests that a significant number of officers, including supervisors, do not feel that they have the appropriate skills, training or strategies to identify challenges in their or their colleagues' mental health and well-being. So I want to ask what your views are on the research done in that, given your comments about wanting to boost frontline well-being, and what are your plans to address that?
So we've talked already about the specialist provision that exists and our investment in relation to that, but as you rightly point out, it's going to be the responsibility and of the people closest to an individual who are likely to see know what trauma they've been exposed to and be able to see what the effects of that is having on them as an individual, whether that's a sergeant, an inspector, or whether that's a colleague and a peer. So your leadership matters goes some way to providing skills to first, second and other managers, and part of that is in relation to understanding and recognising effects on individuals where they're not able to operate within the policing environment and provide that support. In addition to that, we have a programme around people management that explores and gives supervisors skills and knowledge around issues such as health and wellbeing, how to have those I'm going to say, difficult conversations. You know, how do you embark on that conversation to be able to get a sense from an individual and be able to help them in the best way you can? So some practical skills around what services are available, how you embark on those conversations, and then how you best support a colleague to navigate their way and get the best treatment and support that they can. So we've put just under 1,000 office supervisors through the people management training. That's an ongoing programme. So if you think of it in two parts, Your Leadership Matters was value-based in relation to setting the right culture in the organisation and behaviours and providing people with the psychological safety to speak openly. And then the people management approach is in terms of very, very practical tools to support officers and support colleagues. But what we recognise and we can't deny, and policing is not unique in this, there is a stigma attached around mental health and psychological well-being. And so giving our people the tools and the courage and the confidence to be able to support a colleague and open up those conversations is key in dealing with that. And that stigma is community-wide, and the research would say that. So in response to your question, that's an ongoing programme and a very practical approach to supporting, guiding and getting our people the best help that we can if colleagues feel that somebody is starting to suffer from psychological issues, possibly affected by the role that policing has.
Sorry to press you on this, but on the specific aspect of training and the SPF evidence, from what you're saying, are you saying you think that there is enough training?
I'm saying that we've embarked on two big programmes around leadership and support and well-being, and they are ongoing. In relation to the ability for us to train our people, I try to provide the best tools that we can to our people and give them access to these programs. I mean, in addition to that, what you have is an approach and an area of work that DC Spears leads on in relation to Your Safety Matters. So this is in relation to giving people the skills and the equipment to keep themselves safe. And we look at data in relation to where officers are injured, where they are assaulted, and we look at the trends in relation to that. What are the circumstances by which our people are finding themselves both in danger and on the receiving end of violence? And actually what we've seen in recent times is that assaults on officers by under 18s is on the increase. And our assessment of that is where we're stepping into the operational space around supporting vulnerable people, often children. Officers are doing the right thing. They are often, if these kids are missing, then we'll be returning them, and we are seeing assaults in that space. What we're also seeing is that we are seeing a rise in incidents where weapons are involved, where bladed articles are involved, and where there's violence. So all of that needs a response, and Your Safety Matters is the operational and the practical application of that in terms of equipping and giving our people the best skills to deal when they're faced with a situation of conflict or violence, where they're facing somebody who's armed. I'll bring DCC Spears in just to provide you a bit more detail in relation to that.
Yeah, so this has been a three-year programme. It's about reducing impact, and it's about improving safety and well-being. So a big part of that is to focus on where those assaults take place, when they take place. Regrettably, the number of assaults on our officers isn't really reducing and hasn't really reduced over the last 3 years. However, the severity of a large number of those assaults has reduced. What it's also enabled to do quite practically is roll out in the last 18 months an enhanced officer safety training programme. And, you know, in the past, officers would have given a proportion of a day to that training, and now they're committed on an annual basis to 2 days' worth of training. And in that environment, we're trying to equip them as best as we can. So I lead on that work, and there's a focus from every part of the force in terms of trying to take the learning from that.
And is that how's that evaluated, and how do you respond to the SPF evidence that says that officers don't think they have the appropriate skills to, help their colleagues?
I think what you've heard today is that there's a range of measures that we're trying to introduce, and we are on a regular basis recognising that there's more we can do. So another example is, we've kind of refreshed our probationer programme, so new recruits coming into the organisation. It's a different duration in terms of the training programme, but the content is shifting, so we have a lot more trauma-informed practice within there. We're looking at themes like act, don't react, and that's about your communication skills. So I think, in simple answer to your question, there isn't one perfect training programme that will get us into the perfect place, but you've probably heard a little bit about lifelines, about how we endeavour to use TRIM, and there's a range of measures, and it does make the landscape look complicated, but they do have a place and they do have a fit. But organisationally, from a training perspective, we are open to looking at other things that we can do to invest in the wellbeing of our people.
Thank you. Thanks, Kabira.
Very brief supplementary, and then I'll bring
just
in...
Very quickly, Constable and colleagues. You mentioned the matter of a very small minority of under-18s and their behaviour in the community and towards officers. It feels to me, anecdotally and more widely, that this is a growing problem and concern. And I wondered if, following the committee, if you may be able to provide some written feedback on that as an issue. I don't want to detract from the issue of mental health, but I do think it's...
Just so we're clear... Would you mind repeating exactly what you require from us?
Sorry, if you could follow up after the committee on just the scale of the growing challenge of a small minority of under-18s and their behaviour in communities, violent behaviour often, and their behaviour towards police officers. It's something we discussed in Parliament last week with regard to off-road vehicles, for example.
Understood. Thank you.
Very quick supplementary, because we are limited for time, quickly. And I want every member to have a chance
to
come in.
It was in relation to under-18s and the issues of assault. It was decided, according to the SPA, that police cells were no longer appropriate places to keep under-18s. We've seen a recent tragic case, which I won't go into details of, in which someone was released from police custody and committed a serious crime. You feel that your hands are tied in respect of that inability to... hold under-18s where they do potentially pose a danger to officers and the public?
I think one of our greatest challenges in dealing with under-18s as well is very often it's not in the states that we're arresting those under-18s, so we are dealing with a large proportion of young people going missing. We're dealing with a large proportion of vulnerability. So what are your safety matters is telling us that quite often we're conveying young people to a place of safety, and we're not going to constrain them in the same way as we would somebody who's been arrested with handcuffs. So a lot of those assaults are taking place within vehicles. So we're trying to understand that better. And then how do we take a broadly different approach? So I think what's coming through for us is our challenges around handling vulnerability and mental health as much as dealing with crime and just routine operational policing matters.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sharon Dowie.
Thank you. We've heard about the many benefits of body-worn video, not least one of them being the change in behaviours of the public and hopefully the reduction in assaults against officers. Could you advise the committee about the reasons for the delay, again, on issuing them to officers?
Thank you. And you're right, the benefits are significant. We've now completed, conducted complex procurement exercise in relation to this. Ultimately, we will equip 17,000 officers with body-worn video over the next few years. The contract was awarded during the summer, and we're now working with the suppliers to work on the integration of the system. You'll be aware that part of this programme is to maximise the benefits through the already established digital evidence sharing platform, so DESC. So we're partway through the rollout, and what DESC enables us to do is to digitally upload evidence that then can be shared with the Crown, with the courts, with the defence, with the judiciary. So body-worn video is part of that digital evidence. So we're working now to integrate the two systems, working with the suppliers in relation to that. And then we will roll out, once that integration is completed, we will roll out body-worn video, which will follow the same programme and path as DESC. So DESC is already in a number of areas. It started in Dundee. It's been used very effectively there. We're seeing really good and more timely outcomes through the judicial system. So body-worn will start in Dundee. In relation to specific timetables, I would ask that in due course I update the committee in relation to that. There is a significant amount of work to be done, when I'm more confident in terms of the precise date, I'll come back or write to the committee. But in terms, you highlighted some of the benefits, increased trust in relation to public, because people will be able to see what the interactions with the police are like, operational effectiveness in terms of that criminal justice movement of data and evidence, and then in relation to obviously the committee's interest today, safety and well-being of our people. So interactions are captured, and where we see any criminality or assaults on police, we're able to provide that evidence to the courts in a timely and really, really effective way. And I just want to say, in relation to body-worn video, the other big advantage I see in this space is enabling us to share image and film and with partners. So if we think about child protection, we think about domestic abuse, we think about the roles of other partners in that space, you know, a picture speaks a thousand words, and being able to share those images with partners to make good assessments, risk assessments, and actions around protecting the vulnerable is something that I'm obviously very familiar with and has huge, huge benefits.
Thank you for that. I think given the benefits that we know will come with it, I would hope it would be given a number one focus, and we don't have any further delays on rolling them out.
In response to that. There is almost no greater priority for us in rolling this out, and nobody wants the rollout of body-worn video more than I do, because I can absolutely see the benefits. But it is national and so significant in terms of its compatibility and how it features in the broader criminal justice system. Putting cameras on officers' shoulders is straightforward. It's ensuring that it's a national capability, and that it sits and is able to feed the criminal justice system.
Okay, thank you. And the statement there you said about issuing 17,000 officers with body-worn video, but we obviously know that at the moment police numbers are currently at the lowest level since 2007. So unfortunately, I don't think at the moment you've got 17,000 officers to give them to. Could you give us your views on the current staffing levels and the impact on this on police officers with their mental health? And could you also maybe give us an indication of what staffing levels you think would be sufficient?
Yes, thank you. So police officer numbers as of today is 16,467. And in simplistic terms, we're probably half an intake away from achieving our establishment of 16,600 officers. This year alone, we will have trained and recruited over 1,300 officers, which is more than we have done in any year within Police Scotland. And we will achieve in this current financial year our aim of having 16,600 officers within our establishment, which is very positive. One of our bigger challenges is managing some of the abstractions that we have as a consequence of the different tasks that they undertake. So you will have heard of modified officers, some of the challenges that brings. Court abstraction is an enormous challenge for us. On a daily basis, we are seeing over 500 officers being called to court, with a small proportion of them giving evidence. So achieving 16,600, we are working really hard to recruit, and we have a very strong pipeline of people right across Scotland from all backgrounds and experiences with a desire to join the police, and we're trying to provide them the very best possible training. Our broader challenge is as ensuring that we get those officers employed and deployed on the front line, and that does present some challenges for us.
So is it 16,600 you said was your...
That is our budgeted establishment, and we will arrive at that position over the course of this financial year.
So that's a budgeted establishment. What do you think they require? Is that the same as required levels? Do you think you need more?
I think it's a difficult question to ask. I think one of the things that we want to do is have the right balance of the workforce mix. We have a lot of functions that can be carried out by staff, and right now you have seen that we are recruiting civilian investigators into a number of roles within Crime Division, within our people function, within our complaint handling. So I think as an organisation, we would want to work hard to get the right blend and workforce mix between police officers and police staff, and do all that we can to ensure that they're doing the job that we want them to do.
So we've obviously heard about the proportionate response to a crime, and we've also heard, you know, pilots where minor crimes haven't been investigated. So what level would we need? Because police officers also have issues with their mental health, because they want to go and investigate every single crime. The proportionate response to a crime is to go and investigate it. So would that amount of officers actually allow you to investigate every single crime to the required level?
So I just want to reinforce a couple of points in response to your question. So the workforce is 22,000 people. That's really, really important. It's really, really important. And I know there's a feeling from some of our police staff that they don't always feel included in the organisation. I've been gone out of my way to talk about 22,000 people and what those 22,000 people can do. And just to reinforce DCC Spears' point, the officer numbers are really important, but the capacity to investigate crime, to keep the people of Scotland safe, to support victims, is an issue of great focus for me and the whole executive. And the demands by the criminal justice system is one of the largest elements that saps away the capacity of policing in Scotland. It takes away 500 officers per day to go to court, on many occasions not giving evidence, many, many occasions. And equally, if not more important in that, is the fact for every time we go as professionals in this space and we don't give evidence because the trial doesn't go ahead, there's a victim. There's a victim there as well. And in order to maximise the front line of policing, in order to deliver all of the things that we need to, we must collectively, as a system, as leaders in the system, make sure that the criminal justice system works more efficiently. I can't, it's not a position that sits well with me, and I've been very clear about my position in relation to that. I want those officers on the front line of policing, delivering for the communities, and collectively We need to make the criminal justice system work more efficiently. We cannot have victims coming to court over and over again, and we cannot have police officers going to court and not giving evidence. So the 16,600 is important. The proportionate response to crime is important. In relation to not investigating, we assess whether there are lines of inquiry, and if there aren't lines of inquiry, then we bring that crime to a close at that point. That's not to say that if we didn't get further information or evidence, we would reopen. But there's a capacity of a workforce, and then there's a focus by me and by us as a team to say, and what is drawing away from that capacity, and what is putting pressure, to go back to the purpose of the committee today, what is putting pressure on colleagues, and how do we alleviate those pressures? Some of them, we have that direct control of them, and some of them are system-wide issues. And I think you talked earlier with the Federation in relation to our response around mental health. We have a role around that, but it's not our sole responsibility.
So the other stakeholders need to play their part.
Thank you.
I will have to come in. We've got about 10 minutes left and two members still to come in. So I'll bring in Fulton McGregor and then Pauline McNeil.
OK. That's going to be Ben?
No, sorry?
Is it not Ben?
No.
Oh, OK. Sorry, right there. Sorry.
Thanks, Camilla, and good morning to the panel. In the last, I don't know if you noticed the last, if you caught any of the last session, but I was going on thresholds in terms of what police officers have to do in their daily work, and where a threshold, where it would kick in that either management or the individual police officer themselves would say, you know, I've done too much today, too much. Things that could be considered traumatic. I got some good answers in the last session, but I just wanted to ask yourself, where do you think that would be? You know, where would be a line for you and for your management staff in terms of saying, you know, we can't expect officers to do any more until they've had time to de-escalate?
Thank you. I'm going to respond by saying everybody's different, aren't they? We're all different. And some of that is based around experience, some of it's based around individual resilience, some of it's based around the quality of the leadership, some of it's based around maybe other issues that is going on in somebody's life outside the workplace. I'm not able to give you a definitive description. What we've described to the committee, I hope, today is the skills and the tools for our people to be able to have the confidence to say, I'm struggling here, I need some support, or for somebody to recognise those signs in a colleague and be able to intervene. We know there are specific incidents that officers go to where inevitably it is traumatic, and officers would say to us that the top three traumatic incidents, and you won't be surprised by this, are road traffic collisions, are suicides, and are deaths involving babies or children. So there is an obvious and an absolute need for us to wrap around colleagues where they've experienced those things. But sometimes people react in different ways. Some people need the immediate support on the day. Some people will go away and they'll come back in due course. Difficult for me to give you a precise. It's our ability to be emotionally aware, to know what our colleagues are facing. Some people would report that over years the effect of that trauma has an impact, and it's been something that's built up over time, and is not something that is a single incident.
Yeah, thank you. So in the operational context, you all heard a little bit about maybe TRIM. Post-incident procedures, those processes are designed to come in immediately behind those sort of traumatic experiences. But in my experience, having dealt with those types of incidents that the Chief has described, we can all react differently. Some of our staff would want to just get home and be supported by their families. Others will want to engage in our TRIM process, which is that sort of trauma informed support, and we will do that over the course of this year alone. Over 1,500 officers from about almost 400 incidents have participated in those trim processes, and we're continually looking at how do we enhance that. But it's really complex, and there's lots of different circumstances. And I think I said earlier on, so what we're going back to try and do is how do we try and look at what elements of training we can introduce that comes at a point way before the officers are facing those types of circumstances.
Yeah, I think you're right, and I was going to come to that. I think that you know, probably experience would tell us that people do react differently, but a lot of people will actually not respond to the traumatic event right away. That's actually not a very normal reaction. It can be sometime in the future, and we know, depending on the nature of it, can be significant piece in the future. So on that, is there any kind of work been done through all the processes that you've already spoken about today? Where, and I know if this is going to just be so rough, so I don't mean it like that, because I know it probably can't be done like this, but is it almost a recording of how many incidents officers are facing? So, like, you know, I'm trying to think if maybe if they're going out to death. So will the three things that you mentioned, Chief Constable, you know, are they being sort of recorded and logged, and then somebody actually pulling the person in and saying, you know, you've actually had quite a tough year, that sort of thing, you know?
Yeah, and I think that was part of the Health and Wellbeing Action Plan, where at the beginning I talked about one of the themes being undo. So recognising that we can't always avoid trauma for police officers, and therefore at that point of exposure, how do we help undo that exposure? So what we see through the EAP is that since the contract went live, in terms of counselling support, we've provided over 1,100 types. So it's 1,132. And that's everything from in-the-moment counselling, so that's, you know, at that point for individuals, to enhanced counselling, EMDR. So we have a whole range now with the new EAP that recognises that for some people it's in the moment, and for others it might be more of a reflective, cumulative effect. What we're also seeing through EAP is that it's that, but it's also broader issues such as family. So we're starting to see, you know, the theme of family difficulties coming through with the asks from staff and officers as well.
Do I have time for one more?
I'll bring in Pauline, because we'll need to finish very quickly. So Pauline McNeill.
Thank you very much, Chief Constable and panel. So Craig Naylor, Her Majesty's Inspector of Constabulary, kicked off our interest in this subject. He gave very compelling evidence. I'm actually going to go back and read it again, because I think it's important just to establish this is where we started. And for me, listening to him, he was almost describing a crisis in mental health and policing. And that's why we're here today asking these questions. So I just wondered if that is accepted by you, Chief Constable, and your senior officers.
So what we are seeing is an increase in psychological issues affecting our police officers and staff. But as I said earlier, Police Scotland's not unique in terms of as part of a broader community. But I hope what we've described today is the measures, the tools, and the investment we're making, recognising that this is affecting our people, recognising it's affecting our ability to deliver for communities, but also recognising that there are a range and a suite of different approaches that are required, as Director Miller says, very much trying to move into the preventative space, trying to be able to come in and really deal with those issues in the here and now. So we haven't got build up of issues to the point where somebody is just overwhelmed. And I'm a real strong believer in terms of what wraps around that is quality of leadership, recognition, emotional intelligence, but also some of their very, very practical measures that we take. DCC Spears talked there about learning from where we're seeing assaults on officers and staff and the equipment we're providing and how we're adapting that training, learning lessons of where officers and staff have been exposed to particular incidents and saying, well, what's the learning from that and how do we continually build on that so we're giving our people the best information, advice and support to keep them safe.
Thank you very much. The Association of Scottish Police Superintendents said in their submission there's some evidence to suggest that retention rates historically very low begin to increase with officers leaving early in their career. They also point out that officers who join now will be required to work until they're age 60. So that's quite different, I think, if I'm being honest. Up to this point, many police officers have been able to have the benefit of retiring much younger than that. Is that a factor in your thinking as well? Because presumably that means for many police officers they'll work longer and to retain them is going to be harder.
So when we look at the data in relation to people leaving the organisation, not unsurprisingly, more than 70% are people who are retiring and changing the pension regulations for police officers in Scotland means that we have seen people taking advantage of 25 years and being 50 years old. That has had an impact in terms of we can see evidence of experience leaving the organisation, and those people who have high level of skill and years in policing and being able to provide really professional high quality service. So The change in the pension regs has created that. In addition to that, I think we have a different workforce now. I don't know that everybody is joining policing thinking of it as a 35-year career. And we need to accept that. Of course, we want to retain people, but we do lose some people early in service, because it's not for them. And some of what we've heard of today probably provides, say, maybe some of the evidence. Now, that's unfortunate, but clearly these are really, really important jobs. And when you're double crewed with a colleague, you want to know that they are completely committed to it and not having doubts about whether it's right for them. So we would always say to new recruits, we want you to stay, we want you to support you, we want you to be the best officers you can be. But if you recognise it's not for you, and some people do, then, it's too important not to have somebody alongside you who's completely committed.
Just lastly, Katie, you mentioned under the EAP programme the use of EMDR. I had quite a strong interest in this subject area of mental health generally. A lot of people think CBT is too basic, so EMDR seems to be something really important for, because it specifically deals with trauma. I think that's what the programme is designed to do. Does that mean that officers can get access to EMDR on the EAP? Is that what you said? Just wanted to confirm that.
They can, yes.
Because I think that's a very positive thing,
it is,
because of what I've heard about the results.
It is. I think it's recognised, particularly in the space of post-traumatic stress, as being an effective form of support and treatment.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Very much. Just on time, I know, Chief Constable, you've got to be away quite quickly. So on that, we'll bring the session to a close. Thank you very much indeed for your evidence this morning, and we'll have a short suspension to allow for another changeover of panel. Thank you. Thank you very much, members. Just before we begin, I wonder if I can ask members if they're agreeable to taking item 3 in private. I omitted to do that earlier on. Are we agreed? Yeah. Okay, thank you very much. So our final panel this morning consists of senior representatives of the Scottish Police Authority. I'm pleased to welcome Fiona McQueen, Vice Chair, Ms Lynn Brown, Chief Executive, and Mr Alistair Hay, Board Member of the Scottish Police Authority. So welcome to you all, and I intend to allow around 60 minutes for this session. And can I invite Fiona McQueen to make a short opening statement?
Convener, committee members, good morning. Thank you for the opportunity to attend this morning and continue to contribute to the committee's very helpful scrutiny of wellbeing across policing. I'd like to begin by offering our chair, Martin Evans, apologies for his absence today due to a family bereavement, which means as vice chair and chair of the People Committee, I will step in for Martin. And as the convener's already said, I'm now joined by my fellow board member, Alistair Hay, who sits on the People Committee and chairs our Policing and Performance Committee, and also with our Accountable Officer and Chief Executive, Lynn Brown. Woven throughout and across the authority's governance and scrutiny of Police Scotland are matters of workforce wellbeing. The committee has heard this morning from the staff associations and Unison. In addition to the chair's regular meetings with the representatives of these bodies, the People Committee oversight is greatly enhanced by the workforce voice, as these representatives are in attendance at the People Committee and are most helpful when they give us their perspective. On the wider front, across our committees, from approving a business case for the rollout of new software, probing a rise or fall in demand or performance, considering the length of time taken to investigate complaint and conduct matters, all have a people perspective, which are explored in detail. And in the authority's submission ahead of today's session, we explain that the authority has centred its oversight in three specific areas. Leadership commitment, assessing whether or not clear organisational plans are in place to address wellbeing requirements, and measuring progress, overseeing and reviewing how staff wellbeing is measured, reported and acted upon. From a leadership perspective, we are in no doubt of the Chief Constable's commitment to wellbeing. Secondly, we are confident that the Wellbeing Action Plan does draw together in a comprehensive manner the range of wellbeing activities and initiatives essential for the workforce of a large emergency service, both preventive and reactive. Lifelines is an example of learning from other services that we have brought in and we've overseen Police Scotland bringing in as a direct consequence of our trauma event that was very successful in learning and reflecting on what's needed for our workforce or for the Police Scotland workforce. But delivery is key, and the third strand, measuring progress and understanding impact, will flow from tracking the specific, actionable and measurable steps that underpin the Wellbeing Action Plan. Major steps have been taken, and going forward we will build on these foundations and commitment to improve wellbeing, and I expect to see progress being reported to the People Committee. And, Convener, the last thing I would like to mention in my opening remarks relates to officer or staff suicides. And I want to echo the comments that every single suicide is a devastating tragedy and deeply felt. I hope Police Scotland's submission and input today gives the committee more assurance of the corporate awareness of the officers and staff who have died by suicide. As part of our oversight of this matter, Martin Evans has met with Rose Fitzpatrick, former Deputy Chief Constable at Police Scotland and now Chair of the National Suicide Prevention Advisory Group, established to champion and drive suicide prevention in Scotland. He also met separately with Police Scotland Sergeant Laura Gibson, who published a research report for the Churchill Fellowship on wellbeing and resilience in law enforcement. Sergeant Gibson's research focuses on the concept of police officer resilience and explores US police service training programmes that exist to provide officers with the required skills to allow them to cope with the demands of their role. We will expect to see evidence of this work being integrated into the Police Scotland response to wellbeing, in addition to the revised model of policing being developed by Police Scotland to ensure safe systems of work and workload for all officers and staff are built into the new model. Thank you very much for the opportunity to make an opening statement, and we should be pleased to take any questions.
Thank you very much indeed. That's very helpful. I wonder if I can kick off questions by just picking up on the an early point that you included in your opening remarks around the work that you'll be doing to ensure that there are clear plans in place within Police Scotland, obviously one of them being their wellbeing action plan. So I'm interested in hearing a little bit more about what that will involve. And I'd also like to raise a point that I raised with the Chief Constable that David Threadgold had mentioned, and it was an example of where, for example, police officers feel that there's a disconnect with their immediate line managers, and that potentially can impact on well-being, and it can impact on opportunities for that preventative approach to well-being working as it could. So I wonder if that's the type of issue that, if that is raised, and obviously we've been speaking about it today in committee, so is that the type of issue that you would be scrutinising in terms of the way Police Scotland is delivering on plans, in particular around mental wellbeing?
Very much so, Convener. I think there's a number of aspects that we are beginning to tie down with Police Scotland, and that is about measurement. Mm-hmm. Now, we have, as I've said in my opening remarks, the Police Federation, ASPS and Unison and Unite come to the People Committee, and their voice is incredibly helpful in terms of giving us, so when we are overseeing what happens within Police Scotland, then the staff organisations give us their perspective as to whether or not they agree with what's being said. But I think more importantly, they give us their perspective on what could work and what makes it better. So an indicators that we look at, but we are having refined so that we can measure whether or not the actual impact, the work that's been implemented is having the effect it's been wanted. So if we're saying whether it's debriefing, lifelines, we're expecting that to have an impact on officer wellbeing and staff wellbeing. So where's the evidence? So matters such as sickness absence, and it's not always a reduction in sickness absence you're looking at. Sometimes we've heard already this morning about the culture, and it's important that people feel confident, particularly in a policing environment where the culture perhaps has been that, yes, I'm OK, I'm not going, I don't need to come forward, or I don't need to be off sick. So sickness absence, and looking at the range of that. So we're not going to be looking at the average across 22,000 staff. We want to look at, because we've had some indications from officers who've left the service, that actually a low sickness absence rate can also be a red flag if people are afraid to be off sick. So that range of sickness absence right across individual specialty areas, as well as the average uptake of employee assistance programme, we would certainly expect in the first instance to see more of that. Now, there comes a time when we can't be too understanding of continuing to see increase and increase and increase without us being alerted to the fact that something's wrong. So we want to see an increase in employee assistance programme. The staff survey, we will want to see evidence year on year, including the pulse surveys, that things are improving. Ill health retirements, learning from that, and then exit surveys that are carried out. So that would be an example of where we would look to see evidence from Police Scotland that what they are doing is making a positive difference to the workforce. And sorry.
Can I just come in on that? That's good to hear. Those, as you said, that importance of measurement. I suppose a lot of that is around the delivery of well-being responses and approaches. I suppose the example that I spoke about earlier is perhaps more in the operational space.
Sorry, Convener. Yes, in terms of the police officer, so the officer-to-staff ratio is also important, and that will also feature. And again, we need to go down into a bit more granular detail with Police Scotland, because the high level, actually, the officer-to-staff ratio maybe looks as though it's acceptable, but when we look across the country, we'll maybe find there's actually a very large ratio, which is unmanageable for some officers. So that was certainly something that we're looking at, and we're looking at refining how much we take from that. But I think it's also the quality of that relationship and how it moves, and how teams are grouped together. So it's, I think it's more than a straightforward number. We need to look beyond the numbers to make sure that the quality of that relationship and the team building is what we need.
Okay, I'll bring in members now. I'm going to bring in Fulton McGregor and then Russell Finlay.
Hey, thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. We are hearing, and there is indications that numbers of staff absence for psychological disorders is rising. Do you have any idea what the reason for this is? Has policing changed in recent years? Has the nature of policing changed?
So our role as an oversight body has to oversee that, and there certainly has been some changes in society, but perhaps I'll pass over to my colleague Alistair Hay, who chairs the Policing Performance Committee.
I think one of the things that, sitting listening to the evidence that was given earlier, both by the trade unions and the statutory staff bodies and by the Chief Constable, is the importance of culture. And one of the things that we actually recognise, and I myself, I've got over 40 years service in emergency services, is the change in culture. The fact that people now, and I really welcome this, are prepared to come forward and actually say that they've got issues with their mental health. And if you reflect that one in four people in society at some point actually have an issue with their mental health, it shouldn't surprise us that within the police service, especially given some of the unique aspects of their job, may experience at different points issues. And previously, the culture would not to speak about these things, not to be open about these things. But the fact that we see an increase is concerning, absolutely, and there should be no complacency. But in some ways, it should also be welcomed, because if we know where we are, and we can understand what people are experiencing, then we can really begin to bring the right help towards them. So those trends and what the causes are of sickness absence within Police Scotland are absolutely considered within the Performance Committee of the Scottish Police Authority.
Well, the reason I was asking about it, and I was going to ask the previous two panels as well, but I ran out of time on both occasions, and that was because I was going to ask around the is the types of offences that police officers are dealing with, are they changing, and is there have you got any thoughts about whether they are potentially more traumatic, or whether the Police Scotland, in terms of your role and oversight, that maybe doesn't have the resources or expertise yet to deal with it? And the example I'll give, which is probably the obvious example, you said you've been a police officer for 40 years, so you've seen a emergency services in 40 years, so you've seen a big change in this particular area, is that of the internet, and internet offences and online crimes. So is that, I guess what I'm asking there is part of the reason, because we go back to the initial question, is part of the reason, in your opinion, the increase in psychological disorders, because of the nature of police changing, and do Police Scotland have the abilities and expertise to deal with that, or are they playing catch up?
So I wasn't a police officer. I worked. I think just reflecting back on the evidence that the Chief Constable provided, you have seen an increase in psychological disorders within society. So society is changing, and as society changes, then the nature of policing changes with it. And there certainly will be an impact, and this is an area that really could and should be explored more. And I know that Police Scotland have a focus on that at this moment in time. But I think the main point that I would want to put across here is that it's very concerning that people have psychological disorders, and it's an increasing trend within the performance stats that we're looking at. So we need to get an insight and an understanding, but we'd also welcome the fact that people are now prepared to come forward and actually begin to speak about these things, because that gives us a real opportunity to make a difference and to help people in a timely fashion.
You wouldn't take him in if you want to? No. I'll give you that. Thank you.
Russell Finlay, followed by Ronan Mackay.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. Now, suicide is, of course, a very sensitive subject and extremely complex, and I'm fully aware of the Samaritan guidelines, which you referred to in your submission. But, you know, when I first asked the SPA about police suicides in May 2022 at this very committee, there was not even any recording of the numbers. We now know today there have been 20 officers that have lost their lives. You know, with hindsight, and I know you've already referred to this, Alistair, about the culture changing, but this was only 2 years ago. Do you think the SPA perhaps could have done more sooner?
There's always room for improvement, and I think it's important that we learn and reflect and move things forwards. The operational independence of the Chief Constable and the oversight that the SPA has is something that at times is never blurred, but within the People Committee, I think we're getting clearer about the requirements that we have of Police Scotland to demonstrate what they have looked at, what they have reviewed. And there's no doubt learning from not just suicide, but ill health retirements or other feedback that we have from staff is incredibly important in us gathering an assurance and evidence that there are safeguards for the workforce within Police Scotland. So I think we can always improve, Mr Finlay, in terms of what we're doing and how we're learning and moving forwards. And therefore, the more granular information that we have about mental health, mental ill health and distress within the workforce is something that I think we need to pay attention to.
I think the SPA also said was that they'd asked Police Scotland if any of the deaths that were known about, if the work-related matters were potentially a contributory factor, and they were satisfied with Police Scotland's response, which was that there was not. But speaking with families of officers who died, they tell me it very much was. So I wonder, in light of that, whether the SPA would look again, not least because it looks like there's not been a single fatal accident inquiry for any of these tragic deaths.
Well, I think as the Chief and Deputy Spears have said, that the fatal accident inquiry is a matter for the Crown. The discussions I've had with Katie Miller that I'm satisfied will move forwards is that whole learning piece. So the contributory factor of distress of the job is something, whether it is suicide or whether it is other trauma, PTSD or other traumatic events or feelings that the officers and staff has, is important to learn from. And what we have asked Police Scotland to do is be able to learn from these tragic deaths in a sensitive and appropriate manner, and also by reaching out to families, because it's not always welcome, but we need to find a way that is done in a sensitive, professional manner.
Thank you. Now, the Chief Constable has just told us about a rise in the number of assaults on Police Scotland officers by under-18s, and just last year the SPA said that they made a ruling the police cells were not, and I'll direct quote, not an appropriate setting and not in the interests of the child, and the definition of that being aged under 18. Do you think that fairly profound and far-reaching position arrived at by the SPA has some bearing on the uptick in assaults on police officers by under 18s?
I think the pronouncement about where children are kept in custody, I think, came from a human rights-based approach to policing. It came from a conference of wider stakeholders, Police Scotland and the authority, where it was genuinely recognised that the most appropriate place for under-18s would be a secure residential placement. And we don't yet have the data. The police, you know, the Chief's obviously going to be looking at, as she's given that commitment, about what's happening with under-18s. One of the key, the Chair has asked committee chairs to have three priorities for the committees. And one of the priorities that I have chosen and supported by my People Committee colleagues is to look at a reduction in officer assaults, because we see it as absolutely critical to the safety and welfare of the workforce. And that's certainly something, Mr Finlay, we can take into account in terms of looking at stratifying, you know, where the assaults are happening. Police Scotland do have a good knowledge of that, but also looking at the assaults from under-18s.
You mentioned that particular ruling because it was taken by non-elected individuals. I don't know if any communication was made towards the committee or to Parliament generally about this decision.
Not sure that I would necessarily describe it as a ruling, and if I may, Mr Finlay, we would want to perhaps come back to the committee to give a broader outline of the timeline of the dialogue that we've had and decisions that have been taken about how to go forwards.
Now, Police Scotland remains the only police force in the UK without body-worn cameras, and we've heard that they've been delayed yet again. Do the SPA take any responsibility for this failure?
So we have an oversight responsibility, and in terms of challenging plans that come forwards, it may well be, and once we do a lessons learned about the timeline of when it was hoped that body-worn video would be in place compared to it was, there'll probably be learning in terms of all of that. But I'm not sure if the Chief Executive wants to say a bit more about that, or Alistair?
The authority and the Resources Committee have actually been really clear, and have actually pushed for body-worn video. A few years ago, there was an assumption within policing that the authority were averse to technology based on their experiences with the cyber kiosks. And it was made very clear by the authority this was not the case, and where there was public acceptance of technology being to promote trust and confidence in policing, it should be pursued. And there's two things that have happened with that. The first one is the use of technology in child sexual abuse cases for officers who have to look at that evidence. And the technology there has helped them reduce the time they have to do that from, you know, days to hours. And the other area was in body-worn video, where the chair himself, I think, set it out as a priority for him. So we have been very clear in public that this has to be delivered. My own view is that a delay of from, you know, September to March is not unacceptable, and we haven't had this for years and years. And I know in the past the explanation has been given, quite rightly, that we had eight legacy forces who had to come together and they had to sort out other systems before they could turn their attention to body-worn video. So my view is that the authority are very clear this has to be delivered, and they keep the public focus on that through the committees.
I mean, just coming back to that point, it's not just a delay from September to March, it's been a delay of more than 10 years. We're the only police force in the United Kingdom without them. And in terms of the cost, you know, somebody put a figure of £25 million on it from the police at some point, against an annual policing spend of £1.6 billion. It just seems to be unacceptable. And it was only when the Chief Constable came to this committee for the first time did we discover that there were still eight separate computer systems operating from the legacy forces. So I just think SPA seemed to have completely taken their eye off the ball. And Police Scotland's management, where they have failed, surely it's the SPA's job to ensure they get it right.
I can certainly say to you that in the past 3 years, one of the biggest focuses that we've had within the Resources Committee has been the delivery of body-worn video. It is a complex procurement process, which has been successfully conducted. But what it also has is strong interdependencies with other projects within an overall programme that's going on. And sometimes the challenge is the interdependencies have perhaps not been fully recognised and taken into account. So one of the things that we're pressing Police Scotland very strongly on, and they are strong in this, but they are getting stronger, is in programme management. To make sure that, in this case with body-worn video, one of the challenges is that network connectivity, and then the relationship with DESC is to make sure that all the timelines coincide. So we've got an oversight. I absolutely accept that responsibility. We've got an oversight. We will challenge these things, and we will, you know, continually press for delivery, but also for improvements in the approach so that we don't get ourselves into these types of situations in the future.
OK, thank you.
Thanks. Thank you. Ben McPherson, do you want to come in with a short supplementary?
Just briefly on to follow the previous line of questioning, we're all aware of the difficulties with the I6 programme and the continued need for improvement in the overall infrastructure of the IT systems of Police Scotland in time. I just wanted to check that the rollout of body-worn cameras is going to be future-proofed for future IT enhancement in the service when that's able to be delivered.
It's difficult not to reflect on the past, because I think Police Scotland deserves a huge amount of credit for bringing together 8 legacy forces and the various systems that existed and supported and enabled the delivery of frontline policing within those areas. So
cost saving, let's remember as well.
Absolutely, and yeah. I think the cost saving is they've returned £2 billion, effectively to the public purse, to enable that to be spent on other priorities across Scotland. So the arguments are there. The challenge was not insignificant, and they need credit for what they have achieved. So when you get to the point where you've got single systems in place, then some of those problems, they will not be faced with them in the future. So in the sense of future-proofing, the fact that you're dealing with one system, the fact that you're dealing with one set of priorities, it does help. And, nobody can give guarantees that you won't have challenges going forward in the future, but the risks, I believe, are less once you've got that single, effective, functioning organisation with the proper management infrastructure and systems and technology in place.
So I'm just checking that the rollout of the body-worn cameras, if and when there was to be a change to the software that's used at a national level, or I'm just checking we're procuring technology that's going to last the time.
And be
cohesive
coherent within the procurement processes. You look forward and you include appropriate upgrades in that within the initial procurement processes, and then as things come towards the end of life, what you need to do is at the right point in time bring forward the next procurement process so that you keep these things alive. And we've had those conversations within the various committees, specifically within Resources Committee.
Thank you.
Rona Mackay and then Sharon Dowie.
Thank you. Good afternoon, panel. I want to go back to the issue of mental well-being among officers. And without repeating my previous questions to the other two panels, which relate to training or lack of training, according to the SPF, are you satisfied that there is enough training when supervisors and officers are saying they don't have the appropriate skills to actually detect when there's a problem with a colleague?
I think no doubt that the evidence that we're getting to the People Committee is that there are improvements that need to be made. There's no question about that. And we are moving forwards. And we had a People Committee a couple of weeks ago, and we talked about training, lack of what's needed, and I'll be getting a plan at our next People Committee that demonstrates how there can be catch-up for some of the training that has been delayed, and in a proactive way what we're doing about training for the mental health and wellbeing. And it's wider. You've heard this morning from both panels that there's something about actually knowing and understanding that one person being quiet and the other person, another of your team being rowdy, could mean the same in terms of both really struggling. And we've heard the difference between, some people are just like machines, they can go on and on and on, and then others perhaps are going to a child's death and they have a child that same very age. So there needs to be a high level of skill in managing the workforce, on top of knowing and understanding other leadership behaviours that's needed in terms of engaging with your workforce, managing the team, building the team. So it's a highly skilled job, and I think there's more to be done. And I'm expecting evidence from Police Scotland, not just that it's been carried out, so not, as David Threadgold would say, it's a tick box, but actually it's got the evidence of
improvement and making things better for the whole workforce.
It's going to be monitored ongoing.
Very closely, yes.
Thank you. Just one other question I'd like to ask, if I may, and it's about staffing levels. And reports are that 945 officers are eligible to retire before next summer. I think it's important to say, and you can confirm if this is true or not, Police Scotland plan for the highest number of recruits since its inception in 2013. So with that in mind, are you concerned about the immediate staffing levels? And, you know, is that something that's on your radar, that there could be a problem or not?
So always on the risk register, you know, looking at where we are, because obviously people need to give a number of months' notice for retirement. They don't necessarily give a year's notice. It could be 3 months. So the retirements can happen quite quickly. And for all workforces, but if we're looking at Police Scotland, then the training takes certainly 2 years for a probationer to complete their training. So that balance of bringing people in, training them, getting them ready, getting them fit for purpose in time for those who are leaving or who may not leave, is always a balance. But and that most certainly is something that is being kept. And we had a first iteration of new reporting at our last committee meeting, and the papers are there, and it's showing what I would call a dashboard, but it's showing it in with much greater clarity. Leavers, why they're leaving, but also probationers coming in. And you might be interested to know that for, I think, the first time, certainly in Police Scotland's history, we have a non-residential element of probationers coming in. So up until now, it's always been residential. But in terms of having a future focus of how we widen our access to probationer training, there's a programme going on just now at Jackton, and that's non-residential. So we're hoping to
see that. You're talking about Tully Allen, which
yes,
was right. So
yes,
it's not all there now.
So this is a toe in the water. The first time it's been tried.
Okay.
Partly to look at increasing numbers, but also, but mainly from an equality and diversity point of view, how do we support people who can't go to Tully Allen for that residential programme and can manage it from home? And clearly needs to be closely evaluated. So there's a number of factors that at People Committee we're overseeing to make sure we've got the right number of workforce.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you.
I wonder if before I bring in Sharon Dowie, I wonder if I can just come back to the responses that you gave to Rona Mackay on training. And I'm particularly interested in leadership training, and you spoke there about managing the workforce, and obviously there's a leadership role in that clearly. And I just wondered, we also spoke earlier about the amalgamation of 8 forces into 1, and there was a cost-cutting exercise within that. And I wonder if perhaps some of the training that previously was delivered across forces, then if some of that was interrupted or withdrawn as part of the amalgamation, and if some of that was in the context of leadership training. I might be wrong, but it's something that I've been quite curious about over the while. I'd be interested in just a wee bit more in and around leadership training, particularly in the context of what we're discussing today, but also checking in on how that training is being delivered and is bearing out. So almost like a quality assurance process around training. So there's a few questions.
No, and I'll ask my colleagues to come in and help me. But the Your Leadership Matters is what we currently have. It's an online with some in person. And some of the feedback we've had from the Federation is that actually more needs to be done in person. So we are expecting Police Scotland to evaluate, because it is evaluating positively. So that's what we have in place, and a significant number of officers have gone through that. But I'll pass to Lynn and then to Alistair.
Thank you. I'm not sure whether the board members were actually in post when there was a report from the previous HMICS, Jill Imrie, on training, in particular around I'd say senior levels around superintendent, probably the area that would be covered by the ASPS, Staff Association, and her conclusion was that had been neglected in the setup of Police Scotland. And there are reasons as to why, and Police Scotland said at the time why, but there was a recognition, and the Your Leadership Matters was in response to that as part of that report. So there's definitely a gap, and they're trying to address that.
Can I just ask if there's been any evaluation done of Your Leadership Matters, or if there are plans to do that?
So we do receive reports on evaluation of Your Leadership Matter at People Committee, and on the whole it's positive, but there are some advice from the Police Federation that perhaps a bit more could be done in person, and we are receiving ongoing reports on that.
Sorry, I interrupted you.
Not really too much to add. It's just to add that in terms of Your Leadership Matters, the focus at this, as we understand it at this moment in time, is coming down to that first line supervisory management level, sergeants and inspectors of the organisation, having started at the most senior officers in the organisation. And I think we've heard evidence about the importance of those frontline managers having the right skills to support their staff in every way, but particularly in terms of what we're speaking about today, mental health and wellbeing. So I would really welcome that support being given to those frontline managers within the organisation.
Okay,
and one, sorry, convener, one last point as well. In terms of the employee assistance programme, one of the things that was noted at the last performance committee was what that also provides as a 24/7 support and advice helpline for line managers. So if they've got any specific, particularly complex people-related issues, they do have that online support. Now, that's not the only tool, but we would welcome that as an additional tool alongside the training that they are getting.
Thank you. Sharon Dowie, I'll bring you in now.
Thank you. Just going back on to staffing levels. We heard from the previous panel, or we already know that we're at the lowest policing levels since 2007, and we heard from the previous panel about the challenges that they currently face. But I was wondering what staffing levels you see as sufficient. We heard from DCC Alan Spears that they're budgeted to 16,600, which is their target. But what levels do you see as sufficient, and do you have any concerns with the upcoming budget?
The Chief said, Mrs Dowie, the number of 22,000, so we're clearly the warranted officers, and when you need a warranted officer, you need a warranted officer, there's no question about that, but the whole workforce is important. We have an oversight group for the revised model of policing tomorrow, and it's coming to the authority meeting at the end of the month in terms of that new revised model of policing, which will take into account changes in the policing that the Chief is looking for in terms of seeing more frontline, changes to roles and responsibilities of police staff to see what they can do in a more effective and more efficient way than using a warranted officer. And I think once that is in place, and I'll hand over to Alistair in a moment in terms of the Policing and Performance Committee, because there's something about how do we triangulate right across our scrutiny and oversight of making sure that we have a sufficiency of a workforce. So part of that is about the workforce wellbeing, so the attendance figures, the attrition rates, to make sure that what we have is a meaningful stretching job for officers and staff, so that they thrive, as the Chief would say, in the workplace. But there's also how do we meet public demand, and how do we make sure that the performance of Police Scotland is where it should be. And I wonder, Alistair, if you can talk a bit about the performance measures that you look at.
Yeah. So in terms of police officer numbers, ultimately it is for the Chief Constable to determine how many she needs to meet her statutory responsibilities and the expectations. And what she has also done is clearly articulated what her priorities are. And what you then have to do is determine, well, how many officers with what skills do we require to deliver that? And they're currently working through this, as my colleague Fiona has just said, in the revised model of policing. And at the same time, what they're also doing is they're reviewing the model of local policing within Scotland. So work is in process to determine how many warranted officers, how many other staff within that 22,000, what the skill mix is to deliver the sustainable model of policing going forward at this time. Now, where we will then, once the Chief Constable has made that professional determination, then we need to hold her to account for that, and we need to make sure that the intended outcomes are being delivered. So there is a performance, an outcome-focused performance framework in place at this moment in time. Chief Constable spoke earlier about she'll be presenting the vision for the service, and she said there'll be a three-year action plan put in place. There's also an outcome-focused performance framework being put in place for that. And within those performance frameworks, what we will be doing is gathering data, we'll be listening to narrative, we'll be looking for insights from a cross-section, of staff, from the representatives, but also communities, also local government and other stakeholders, to provide us with an evidence base that demonstrates that the stated, the intended outcomes are actually being achieved. So we will do this in a very structured way, and we will gather that evidence. And that's, I believe, the value and the strong role that the Scottish Police Authority has to play in terms of police numbers.
And I think in terms of the budget that you asked, clearly with such a big work, the budget, the proportion of budget on workforce being so large, then clearly budget is very important. And I wonder if our accountable officer, the Chief Executive, could say something.
Sure. Can I just clarify, what you talk about a warranted officer, is that someone who's basically frontline out in the street?
Well, any police officer rather than police staff.
Right, OK.
Got a warrant card, that's right.
Yeah, right.
Have the powers of constable.
Powers of constable, yeah. Shall I? So on the budget, in terms of your question, the budget for next year, we are sort of formulating our ask of the government around the budget. With Police Scotland, that will be based on the three-year business plan. That was actually an ask of this committee last year when they looked at the budget. I think it was a question from Mr. Swinney, who asked about the model of policing. Was it sufficient going forward in terms of the society and crimes, etc., and how we want to work, and the role of technology? So that is what this three-year business plan is. It's based on that ask that was from this committee last year, and we will feed that into the Scottish Government in terms of our ask. In terms of financial parameters, we will set out options depending on what that looks like, against flat cash, which is what the current sort of view is. There's been nothing more indicated on that. So that, I understand, Convener, this committee will look at that in a bit more detail. So we are formulating our ask at the moment.
Okay, and just one quick question, again, going back on to training. Again, it's about the number of courses and how much focus there is on it. Again, from the first panel, we heard about lack of training around HR issues, not always trained to the right standard. And one of the things that SPF had said was about 3,500 officers not safety trained. Is that warranted officers that should be out in the street that haven't had any safety training?
So we receive reports to People Committee, and the officer safety training is something that is refreshed. So they will have their training, and there's some excellent health and safety data that shows that maintaining that level of training improves officer safety. So what I've asked to come back to the next committee is when we will see that backlog resolved. So it's not that they've never been trained, it's that they've not had refresher training, but that is important that they have that for their protection. Not all of them will be front facing, some of them will be, as the Chief has talked about, the middle office, but the number we are looking to see reduced to, there's always going to be a small number who are out of training in terms of whether sickness absence or annual leave, but that number is not acceptable to us and would expect to see that significantly reduced.
So you're getting information back on that?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay,
yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Pauline McNeill.
Thank you very much. Good morning. So it's a similar question to Sharon Dowie. It's not a phrase that I recall Police Scotland using in the past. An officer, by the very definition, is warranted. Is it not more of an English kind of...
Oh, it's police... the previous chief, Sir Ian Livingston, used to talk about that, the warrant of a constable. So it's maybe just... I apologise for confusing my shorthand of a police officer versus a police staff. So staff in police custody, yeah, or C3, civilian staff, are not warranted.
I just wondered why we're now adopting this phrase that is... But an officer, by the very definition, has a warrant card. And maybe I'm barking up the wrong tree here, you'll tell me. But is this a way of making this definition because in the reorganisation plan, you're going to introduce what England has, which is these, is it PDSOs, which we don't have in Scotland, and they don't have warrant cards? I'm just a little bit concerned that maybe that Police Scotland are not being upfront with us about this, or just... but. Because surely, if that is the plan, it should be full. You know, it should be full transparency around that.
There would be absolute full transparency, mm-hmm, and it's something that I've heard used. So I joined the Scottish Police Authority in April 2021. It's something that I've heard used, and it's a way to the warranted officer, who you can't, office of a constable, versus police staff. And I think there's subtle but distinct differences in terms of conditions and regulations. You heard this morning from David Malcolm that police staff can't be required to, maybe morally feel obliged to do overtime. So it's, I apologise for if there's been any confusion, but there's no question of that being used. It's actually been used to distinct, so there are 16,600, or there ought to be, warranted officers. There's no question that there is anything untowards or underhand about it.
Because there was an advert that was put out a month ago where it caused controversy, because it was saying that on the same salary as a police officer, that would employ civilians to do some of the jobs that police officers do, and that's not, to my knowledge, it's not a development we've had. I didn't really understand why you would want to do that, why you'd want to take the role of police officers who, by and large, are complaining about a lack of resource on the front line. So it's just a bit of... I'm confused by...
OK, so what the chief constable will talk about is making sure that warranted officers are doing what only police officers are doing, only what a police officer can do. And where things can be perhaps more efficient or effective, because police officers tend... And apologise, Ms McNeill, police officers probably a very good way to describe...
No, you don't need to apologise. No, yeah. It's just that I'm just being honest. I just feel as a, what is the reason why you're changing the terminology? No. And the backdrop, just being honest with you, is that what was this subtle change between we're not going to have police officers doing the jobs they used to do?
No. So that's... But
because
that...
I don't think it was just me who was concerned about that. I think the Federation were concerned about that as well. Do you know what I'm talking about?
I do completely know what you're talking about. One of the things that police officers do is they get moved around. So where you can have consistency of a member of police staff, civilian staff, to do something, then they keep that expertise. They've actually got a career path to it, and it's something the trade unions, mm-hmm, are very supportive of. But it's making sure that the deployment of a police officer is to work that only a police officer can do.
Thank you.
Thank you. I wonder if I can come in, we've got a wee bit of time left, and I wonder if I can come in with a couple of questions. The first one is around overtime. So obviously that's been raised this morning in the other panels, and it's fair to say that there is a significant cost to Police Scotland in and around that, but there's also not just the financial cost, but the wellbeing cost to police officers in terms of rest days being cancelled, overtime being required, which we know is part of the nature of the role. Is the impact of overtime something that the SPA has been monitoring or looking at?
I could talk to the finance, and your committee have been looking at the impact. Mm-hmm. In terms of the finance, I think there were some figures quoted recently, Chair, of about $30 million, I think, in the press around overtime for 23-24. It was roughly about $28.7 million, just near enough 30. However, we have a budget of around $25 million every year for overtime. It is something that is required. It is recognised as a way of working for police. What happened in 23-24 was the financial challenge that became really apparent around at this time last year, and the need to look at that, and they actually pulled back on the overtime. It would have been much more. But we do have a standard budget every year for overtime, for core overtime, which is operational, and non-core, which is around events. So it is something that's recognised. I know that the committee, people committee, are looking at the impact on this in terms of operational levels and the impact on wellbeing. So I'll pass to Ms McQueen.
Before you come in on that, thanks for that. One of the earlier panel members spoke about, I'm not sure if it was the Chief Constable, spoke about some of the work that has been done, in particular to pull the commitment of arising from major events, so football matches, parades, that type of thing, away from Police Scotland, so taking a more risk-positive approach. I think it was in response to a question that Ben McPherson asked. Do you think that there's more that could be done? And I'm just thinking purely from the budget perspective, in and around that.
The charges for football events, etc., they're approved every year at the budget set in March, and they are based on a formula that is used, I think, across the UK. One of the things, in terms of your charging for an event under the financial framework, is that it has to be cost recovery. It cannot be a profit. So it has to be cost recovery. So there's no aspect to get any surplus from the events that you are policing. So that is the background to that. I think what they were saying earlier on was there's a move where they are confident, I think it was superintendent, where there's a move where they are confident that promoters or whoever's been on an event, they're confident they can deliver a safe event, police will pull back. But there is a whole range of rates based on the event that is based on cost recovery.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Before I bring Fiona McQueen in, I've got a couple of members that are interested in just picking up supplementaries on the budgetary side of overtime. So I'll bring in Russell and then Ben McPherson.
Thank you. Just on the basis of the financial situation we're in, can Glasgow or Scottish policing afford the Commonwealth Games?
I have no knowledge on what that would actually mean for policing in terms of costing. We haven't been involved in the detail of that. So my assumption would be that would be where there's a marginal cost, where it's an additional cost, that would be refunded by the Commonwealth Games Federation.
I wonder if that's something that we could maybe pick up in our pre-budget scrutiny.
Thank you.
If that would be helpful. Ben McPherson?
I was just wondering how much engagement there is on scheduling. So, for example, in this city, when we have the August festivals, you know, the additional pressure on the police service is obvious. But then if you put in the start of the football season and there are home games at Tynecastle or Easter Road, and if that's against one of the big Glasgow clubs, for example, that has an added impact, there's going to be a very big concert at Murrayfield during the festivals next year. I'm not. Police Scotland have never said to me, as an MSP who represents part of the city, that they have difficulties and aren't able to meet that capacity. But to me, it does seem that there needs to be a logical approach to scheduling and considering the demands on the force.
I don't know if there's anything that happens at Policing and Performance Committee.
These are known knowns. when these things, the vast majority of them, are happening in Edinburgh and other Scottish cities, and also things like festivals in rural Scotland, they're known knowns. Police Scotland know in advance that the majority of these things are going to happen, and they schedule their... My understanding is that they can schedule their shift patterns, the number of officers that are on duty within certain margins to accommodate these issues. And I think what it highlights is the importance of effective strategic workforce planning, and it also highlights the importance of having a coordination approach to resourcing, making the best use of the resources that you have available. And these are two issues that we certainly challenge Police Scotland on, and ask them to provide evidence that it's been done efficiently and effectively. And it also ties in with the question on overtime. Police Scotland is an organisation that has to breathe in and it has to breathe out, because although it can anticipate much of the demand, it also has a level of unanticipated demand, just by the very nature of being an emergency service, and a reasonable amount of overtime helps them to flex, to breathe in and breathe out in these types of situations. So these are conversations that do place, I know do take place within Police Scotland, and they are the types of questions that have been asked by our committees.
Do they take place with the other parties involved, I guess is my question, you know. Thank you.
My understanding, if I may, there's a Scottish government events groups. And so, for example, when there was going to be the road races for the cycling events for the World Championships last year, all the Scottish government would coordinate that with local authorities and policing. That's my understanding.
And I've no doubt that happens at that level with central government, but I mean more with private sector organisations, with private interests, you know. It just seems to me that there's an...
I wonder whether we come back,
could you?
To give a bit more information. And if I may bring in the Chief Executive in a moment about mental health and wellbeing in forensics. But I think that the overtime, the two sides of the coin of the overtime piece, in terms of to have the right number of people on duty, you might need to deploy overtime, which in itself might be exhausting. And so there's a number of factors. We've already heard from the Chief about some of the inefficiencies in the justice system, which, if they were streamlined, could help reduce the need for overtime. There's something about having the right number of workforce, so getting these probationers through so that we have enough police officers in post, and that then helps reduce sickness absence, it helps reduce the need for overtime. And it is something at the People Committee, to answer your question, that we look at. And it's that balance. It's not about saying we can't have overtime because it's too expensive. It's about saying, in a world... So the police services, as we've just heard, but that the dialogue is one that has needs to have surge capacity, needs to for a weekend or a week, needs to have more people. And that often is about overtime and rostering. But ideally, overtime should be as minimal as possible, so that staff can get, police officers can get their roster break, refresh, and come back to do the job that they're so passionate about. But I wonder, Convener, if I may ask Lynn to say something about...
If I may, Convener, it's just that we've been talking about police officers and police staff, and I know the authority would like the committee to understand forensics, and there's because... The scene examiners, by the nature of their work, are exposed to traumatic scenes on a regular basis. And there used to be substantial levels of sickness in that area. And I'd just like to explain how forensic services have tackled that and continue to do that. So, first of all, there was a comment earlier on about the number of initiatives on wellbeing, and there are a number of corporate initiatives that the forensics can take part in and benefit from. So we've heard about them today. The Employee Assistance Programme, the Occupational Health, the Trim Management, Wellbeing Champions. Also, they've got particular initiatives for the Scene Examiners. So, and David Malcolm from Unison touched on it earlier today, where he mentioned about they have a tasking unit And he said that helped with the well-being in forensics. That's the scene examiners. There's about 100 scene examiners out of the 600 staff. They also look at shift patterns. They look at capability. Team managers have been put in place. They've also now, they're able to use the facility of Police Scotland to have an octor order for recovery. They try to understand much better short and long-term sickness and act in that. But in addition, they're doing a specific project on psychological supervision project, which is looking at the psychological impact of being a scene examiner and to normalise the support and reduce the stigma of asking for this. And out of the, I think, 93% of the scene examiners have gone through, it's a one-to-one meeting with an independent counsellor, and that will be evaluated, but I just thought that whole forensic scene examiner, we just wanted to let the committee be aware of the action that's been taken in that area.
No, thank you for that update. I mean, a really important body of experts that are deployed on a regular basis, so we appreciate that helpful update. That brings us slightly over time, so can I thank you all for coming along today and providing very helpful evidence. And with that, we'll close the meeting and move into private session. Thank you.